Dune, House Harkonnen, by Brian Herbert and Kevin J. Anderson. Narrated by Scott Brick. Copyright 2000 by Herbert Limited Partnerships. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Herbert Properties, LLC, and the Trident Media Group, and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Discovery is dangerous, but so is life. A man unwilling to take risk is doomed never to learn, never to grow, never to live. Planetologist Pardo Kynes, an Arrakis primer, written for his son Liet. When the sandstorm came howling up from the south, Pardo Kynes was more interested in taking meteorological readings than in seeking safety. His son, Liet, only 12 years old, but raised in the harsh ways of the desert, ran an appraising eye over the ancient weather pod they had found in the abandoned botanical testing station. He was not confident the machine would function at all. Then Liet gazed back across the sea of dunes toward the approaching tempest. The wind of the demon in the open desert. Hulasikali wala. Almost instinctively, he checked his stillsuit fittings. Coriolis storm, Kynes corrected, using a scientific term instead of the Fremen one his son had selected. Winds across the open flatlands are amplified by the planet's revolutionary motion. Gusts can reach speeds up to 700 kilometers per hour. As his father talked, the young man busied himself sealing the egg-shaped weather pod, checking the vent closures, the heavy doorway hatch, the stored emergency supplies. He ignored their signal generator and distress beacon. The static from the sandstorm would rip any transmissions to electromagnetic shreds. In pampered societies, Liet would have been considered just a boy. But life among the hard-edged Fremen had given him a tightly coiled adulthood that few others achieved even at twice his age. He was better equipped to handle an emergency than his father. The elder Kynes scratched his sandy gray beard. A good storm like this can stretch across 4 degrees of latitude. He powered up the dim screens of the pod's analytical devices. It lifts particles to an altitude of 2,000 meters and suspends them in the atmosphere so that long after the storm passes, dust continues to fall from the sky. Liet gave the hatch lock a final tug, satisfied that it would hold against the storm. The Fremen call that El Sayal, the rain of sand. One day when you become planetologists, you'll need to use more technical language, Pardo Kynes said in a professorial tone. I still send the Emperor occasional reports, though not as often as I should. I doubt he ever reads them. He tapped one of the instruments. Ah, I believe the atmospheric front is almost upon us. Liet removed a porthole cover to see the oncoming wall of white, tan, and static. A planetologist must use his eyes, as well as scientific language. Just look out the window, father. Kynes grinned at his son. It's time to raise the pod. Operating long-dormant controls, he managed to get the dual bank of suspensor engines functioning. The pod tugged against gravity, heaving itself off the ground. The mouth of the storm lunged toward them, and Liet closed the cover plate, hoping the ancient meteorological apparatus would hold together. He trusted his father's intuition to a certain extent, but not his practicality. The egg-shaped pod rose smoothly on suspensors, buffeted by precursor breezes. Ah, there we are, Kynes said. Now our work begins. The storm hit them like a blunt club and vaulted them high into the maelstrom. Days earlier, on a trip into the deep desert, Pardo Kynes and his son had discovered the familiar markings of a botanical testing station, abandoned thousands of years before. Fremen had ransacked most of the research outposts, scavenging valuable items, but this isolated station in an armpit of rock had gone undiscovered until Kynes spotted the signs. He and Liet had cracked open the dust-encrusted hatch to peer inside like ghouls about to enter a crypt. They were forced to wait in the hot sun for atmospheric exchange to clear out the deadly stale air. Pardo Kynes paced in the loose sand, holding his breath and poking his head into the darkness, waiting until they could enter and investigate. These botanical testing stations had been built in the golden age of the old empire. Back then, Kynes knew, this desert planet had been nothing special, with no resources of note, no reason to colonize. When the Zensuni wanderers had come here after generations of slavery, they'd hoped to build a world where they could be free. But that had been before the discovery of the spice melange, the precious substance found nowhere else in the universe. And then everything had changed. Kynes no longer referred to this world as Arrakis, the name listed in Imperial records, but instead used the Fremen name, Dune. Though he was by nature Fremen, he remained a servant of the Padishah emperors. Elrud IX had assigned him to unravel the mystery of the spice, where it came from, how it was formed, where it could be found. For 13 years Kynes had lived with the desert dwellers. He had taken a Fremen wife, and he'd raised a half-Fremen son to follow in his footsteps, to become the next planetologist on Dune. Kynes's enthusiasm for this planet had never dimmed. He thrilled at the chance to learn something new, even if he had to thrust himself into the middle of a storm. The pod's ancient suspensors hummed against the Coriolis howl like a nest of angry wasps. The meteorological vessel bounced on swirling currents of air, a steel-walled balloon. Wind-borne dust scoured the hull. "This reminds me of the aurora storms I saw on Seleucus Secundus," Kynes mused. "Amazing things. Very colorful and very dangerous. The hammer wind can come up from out of nowhere and crush you flat. You wouldn't want to be caught outside." "I don't want to be outside in this one either," Liet said. Stressed inward, one of the side plates buckled. Air stole through the breach with a thin shriek. Liet lurched across the deck toward the leak. He'd kept the repair kit and foam sealant close at hand, certain the decrepit pod would rupture.
"We are held in the hand of God, and could be crushed at any moment."
"That's what your mother would say," the planetologist said without looking up from the skeins of information pouring through the recording apparatus into an old data pack.
"Look, a gust clocked at 800 kilometers per hour.
His voice carried no fear, only excitement.
"What a monster storm!"
Liet looked up from the stone-hard sealant he had slathered over the thin crack. The squealing sound of leaking air faded, replaced by a muffled hurricane din.
"If we were outside, this wind would scour the flesh off our bones."
Kynes pursed his lips.
"Quite likely true, but you must learn to express yourself objectively and quantitatively."
"Scour the flesh off our bones" is not a phrasing one would include in a report to the Emperor. The battering wind, the scraping sand, and the roar of the storm reached a crescendo. Then, with a burst of pressure inside the survey pod, it all broke into a bubble of silence. Liet blinked, swallowing hard to clear his ears and throat. Intense quiet throbbed in his skull. Through the hull of the creaking vessel, he could still hear Coriolis winds like whispered voices in a nightmare.
"We're in the eye."
Glowing with delight, Pardo Kynes stepped away from his instruments.
"A siege at the center of the storm. A refuge where you would least expect it."
Blue static discharges crackled around them, sand and dust rubbing together to generate electromagnetic fields.
"I would prefer to be back in the siege right now," Liet admitted.
The meteorological pond drifted along in the eye, safe and silent after the intense battering of the storm wall. Confined together in the small vessel, the two had a chance to talk, as father and son. But they didn't. 10 minutes later, they struck the opposite sandstorm wall, thrown back into the insane flow with a glancing blow of the dust-thick winds. Liet stumbled and held on. His father managed to maintain his footing. The vessel's hull vibrated and rattled. Kynes looked at his controls, at the floor, and then at his son.
I'm not sure what to do about this. The suspensors are...
With a lurch, they began to plunge, as if their safety rope had been severed.
Failing!
Liet held himself against an eerie weightlessness as the crippled pod dropped toward the ground, which lay obscured by dusty murk. As they tumbled in the air, the planetologist continued to work the controls. The haphazard suspensors sputtered and caught again just before impact. The force from the Holtzman field generator cushioned them enough to absorb the worst of the crash. Then the storm pod slammed into the churned sand, and the Coriolis winds roared overhead like a spice harvester trampling a kangaroo mouse under its treads. A deluge of dust poured down, released from the sky. Bruised, but otherwise unharmed, Pardo and Liet Kynes picked themselves up and stared at each other in the afterglow of adrenaline. The storm headed up and over them, leaving the pod behind. After working a sand snork out through the clogged vent opening, Liet pumped fresh air into the stale confinement. When he pried open the heavy hatch, a stream of sand fell into the interior, but Liet used a static foam binder to pack the walls. Using a scoop from his frem kit as well as his bare hands, he set to work digging them out. Pardo Kynes had complete confidence in his son's abilities to rescue them, so he worked in dimness to collate his new weather readings into a single, old-style data pack. Blinking as he pushed himself into the open air like an infant emerging from a womb, Liet stared at the storm-scoured landscape. The desert was reborn. Dunes moved along like a marching herd. Familiar landmarks changed. Footprints, tents, even small villages erased. The entire basin looked fresh and clean and new. Covered with pale dust, he scrambled up to more stable sand, where he saw the depression that hid the buried pod. When they'd crashed, the vessel had slammed a crater into the wind-stirred desert surface just before the passing storm dumped a blanket of sand on top of them. With Fremen instincts and an inborn sense of direction, Liet was able to determine their approximate position, not far from the south false wall. He recognized the rock forms, the cliff bands, the peaks and rills. If the winds had blown them a kilometer farther, the pod would have crashed into the blistering mountains, an ignominious end for the great planetologist, whom the Fremen revered as their Uma, their prophet. Liet called down into the hole that marked the buried vessel.
Father, I believe there's a CH in the nearby cliffs. If we go there, the Fremen can help us dig out the pod.
Good idea, Kynes answered, his voice muffled.
Go check to make sure. I'll stay here and work. I've got an idea.
With a sigh, the young man walked across the sand toward the jutting elbows of ochre rock. His steps were without rhythm, so as not to attract one of the great worms. Step, drag, pause. Drag, pause. Step, step. Drag, step, pause, step. Liet's comrades at Red Wall CH, especially his blood brother Warwick, envied him for all the time he spent with the planetologist. Uma Kynes had brought a vision of paradise to the desert people. They believed his dream of reawakening Dune and followed the man. without the knowledge of the Harkonnen overlords, who were only on Arrakis to mine the spice, and viewed people only as a resource to be squeezed. Kynes oversaw armies of secret, devoted workers who planted grasses to anchor the mobile dunes. These Fremen established groves of cacti and hardy scrub bushes in sheltered canyons, watered by dew precipitators. In the unexplored south polar regions, they had planted palmeries, which had gained a foothold and now flourished. A lush demonstration project at Plaster Basin produced flowers, fresh fruit, and dwarf trees. Still, though the planetologist could orchestrate grandiose, world-spanning plans, Liet did not trust his father's common sense enough to leave him alone for long. The young man went along the ridge until he found subtle blaze marks on the rocks, a jumbled path no outsider would notice, messages in the placement of off-colored stones that promised food and shelter under the respected Al-Amya traveler's benediction rules. With the aid of strong Fremen in the CH, they could excavate the weather pod and drag it to a hiding place where it would be salvaged or repaired. Within an hour, the Fremen would remove all traces and let the desert fall back into brooding silence. But when he looked back at the crash site, Liet was alarmed to see the battered vessel moving and lurching, already protruding a third of the way out of the sand. With a deep-throated hum, the pod heaved and strained, like a beast of burden caught in a belly-to-goosen quagmire. But the pulsing suspensors had only enough strength to wrench the vessel upward a few centimeters at a time. Liet froze when he realized what his father was doing. Suspensors. Out in the open desert. He ran, tripping and stumbling, an avalanche of powder sand following his footsteps. Father, stop! Turn them off! He shouted so loudly that his throat grew raw. With dread in the pit of his stomach, he gazed across the golden ocean of dunes toward the hellish pit of the faraway Cielago Depression. He scanned for a telltale ripple, the disturbance indicating deep movement. Father, come out of there! He skidded to a stop in front of the open hatch as the pod continued to shift back and forth, straining. The suspensor fields thrummed. Grabbing the edge of the doorframe, Liet swung himself through the hatch and dropped inside the weather pod, startling Kynes. The planetologist grinned at his son. It's some sort of automated system. I don't know what controls I bumped into, but this pod just might lift itself out in less than an hour. He turned back to his instruments. It gave me time to collate all our new data into a single storage. Liet grabbed his father by the shoulder and pulled him from the controls. He slammed his hands down on the emergency cutoff switch, and the suspensors faded. Confused, Kynes tried to protest, but his son urged him toward the open hatch. Get out, now! Run as fast as you can toward the rocks! But... Liet's nostrils flared in angry exasperation. Suspensors operate on a Holtzman field, just like shields. You know what happens when you activate a personal shield out in the open sand? The suspensors are working again? Kynes blinked, then his eyes lit up as he understood. Ah, a worm comes. A worm always comes. Now run! The elder Kynes staggered out of the hatch and dropped to the sand. He recovered his balance and oriented himself in the glaring sun. Seeing the cliff line Liet had indicated, a kilometer away, he trudged off in a jerky, mismatched walk, stepping, sliding, pausing, hopping forward in a complicated dance. The young Fremen dropped out of the hatch and followed along as they made their way toward the safety of rocks. Before long, they heard a hissing, rolling sound from behind. Liet glanced over his shoulder, then pushed his father over a dune crest. Faster! I don't know how much time we'll have! They increased their pace. Pardo stumbled, got back up. Ripples arrowed across the sands directly toward the half-buried pod. Toward them. Dunes lurched, rolled, then flattened with the inexorable tunneling of a deep worm rising to the surface.
"Run with your very soul!" They sprinted toward the cliffs, crossed a dune crest, slid down, then surged forward again, the soft sand pulling at their feet. Liet's spirits rose when he saw the safety of rocks less than 100 meters away. The hissing grew louder as the giant worm picked up speed. The ground beneath their boots trembled. Finally, Kynes reached the first boulders and clutched them like an anchor, panting and wheezing. Liet pushed him farther, though, onto the slopes, to be sure the monster could not rise from the sand and strike them. Moments later, sitting on a ledge, wordless as they sucked hot air through their nostrils to catch their breath, Pardo Kynes and his sons stared back to watch a churning whirlpool form around the half-buried weather pod. In the loosening powder, as the viscosity of the stirred sand changed, the pod shifted and began to sink. The heart of the whirlpool rose up in a cavernous, scooped mouth. The desert monster swallowed the offending vessel along with tons of sand, forcing all the debris down into a gullet lined with crystal teeth. The worm sank back into the arid depths, and Liet watched the ripples of its passage, slower now, returning into the empty basin. In the pounding silence that followed, Pardo Kynes did not look exhilarated from his near brush with death. Instead, he appeared dejected.
"We lost all that data."
The planetologist heaved a deep breath.
"I could have used our readings to understand those storms better."
Liet reached inside a front pocket of his stillsuit and held up the old-style data pack he had snatched from the pod's instrument panel.
"Even while watching out for our lives, I can still pay attention to research."
Kynes beamed with fatherly pride. Under the desert sun, they hiked up the rugged path to the safety of the CH.
Behold, O man, you can create life, you can destroy life, but lo, you have no choice but to experience life, and therein lies both your greatest strength and your greatest weakness.
Orange Catholic Bible, Book of Kimla Septima, Chapter 5, Verse 3. On oil-soaked Giedi Prime, the work crew left their fields at the end of a typically interminable day. Encrusted with perspiration and dirt, the workers slogged from trench-lined plots under a lowering red sun, making their way back home. In their midst, Gurney Halleck, his blonde hair a sweaty tangle, clapped his hands rhythmically. It was the only way he could keep going, his way of resisting the oppression of Harkonnen overlords, who for the moment were not within earshot. He made up a work song with nonsense lyrics, trying to get his companions to join in, or at least to mumble along with the chorus.
"We toil all day, the Harkonnen way, hour after hour, we long for a shower, just workin' and workin' and workin'."
The people trudged along silently. Too tired after 11 hours in the rocky fields, they hardly gave the would-be troubadour a notice. With a resigned sigh, Gurney finally gave up his efforts, though he maintained his wry smile.
"We are indeed miserable, my friends, but we don't have to be dismal about it."
Ahead lay a low village of prefabricated buildings, a settlement called Dmitri in honor of the previous Harkonnen patriarch, the father of Baron Vladimir. After the Baron had taken control of House Harkonnen decades ago, he'd scrutinized the maps of Giedi Prime, renaming land features to his own tastes. In the process, he had added a melodramatic flair to the stark formations. Isle of Sorrows, Perdition Shallows, Cliff of Death. No doubt a few generations hence, someone else would rename the landmarks all over again. Such concerns were beyond Gurney Halleck. Though poorly educated, he did know the Imperium was vast, with 1 million planets and decillions of people. But it wasn't likely he'd travel even as far as Harko City, the densely packed, smoky metropolis that shed a perpetual ruddy glow on the northern horizon. Gurney studied the crew around him, the people he saw every day. Eyes downcast, they marched like machines back to their squalid homes, so sullen that he had to laugh aloud. "Get some soup in your bellies, and I'll expect you to start singing tonight. Doesn't the O.C. Bible say, 'Make cheer from your own heart, for the sun rises and sets according to your perspective on the universe?'" A few workers mumbled with faint enthusiasm. It was better than nothing. At least he had managed to cheer them up some. With a life so dreary, any spot of color was worth the effort. Gurney was 21, his skin already rough and leathery from working in the field since the age of 8. By habit, his bright blue eyes drank in every detail, though the village of Dimitri and the desolate fields gave him little to look at. With an angular jaw, a too round nose, and flat features, he already looked like an old farmer and would no doubt marry one of the washed-out, tired-looking girls from the village. Gurney had spent the day up to his armpits in a trench, wielding a spade to throw out piles of stony earth. After so many years of tilling the same ground, the villagers had to dig deep in order to find nutrients in the soil. The barons certainly didn't waste solaris on fertilizers. Not for these people. During their centuries of stewardship on Gedi Prime, the Harkonnens had made a habit of wringing the land for all it was worth. It was their right, no, their duty, to exploit this world, and then move the villages to new land and new pickings. One day when Gedi Prime was a barren shell, the leader of House Harkonnen would undoubtedly request a different fief, a new reward for serving the Padishah emperors. There were, after all, many worlds to choose from in the Imperium. But galactic politics were of no interest to Gurney. His goals were limited to enjoying the upcoming evening, sharing a bit of entertainment and relaxation down at the meeting place. Tomorrow would be another day of back-breaking work. Only stringy, starchy crawl tubers grew profitably in these fields. Though most of the crop was exported as animal feed, the bland tubers were nutritious enough to keep people working. Gurney ate them every day, as did everyone else. Poor soil leads to poor taste. His parents and co-workers were full of proverbs, many from the Orange Catholic Bible. Gurney memorized them all and often set them to tunes. Music was the one treasure he was allowed to have, and he shared it freely. The workers spread out to their separate but identical dwellings, defective prefabricated units House Harkonnen had bought at discount and dumped there. Gurney gazed ahead to where he lived with his parents and his younger sister, Beth. His home had a brighter touch than the others. Old, rusted cook pots held dirt in which colorful flowers grew. Maroon, blue, and yellow pansies, a shock of daisies, even sophisticated-looking calla lilies. Most houses had small vegetable gardens where the people grew plants, herbs, vegetables, though any produce that looked too appetizing might be confiscated and eaten by roving Harkonnen patrols. The day was warm and the air smoky, but the windows of his home were open. Gurney could hear Beth's sweet voice in a lilting melody. In his mind's eye, he saw her long, straw-colored hair. He thought of it as flaxen, a word from old Terran poems he had memorized, though he had never seen homespun flax. Only 17, Beth had fine features and a sweet personality that had not yet been crushed by a lifetime of work. Gurney used the outside faucet to splash the gray, caked dirt from his face, arms, and hands. He held his head under the cold water, soaking his snarled blonde hair, then used blunt fingers to maul it into some semblance of order. He shook his head and strode inside, kissing Beth on the cheek while dripping cold water on her. She squealed and backed away, then returned to her cooking chores. Their father had already collapsed in a chair. Their mother bent over huge wooden bins outside the back door, preparing crawl tubers for market. When she noticed Gurney was home, she dried her hands and came inside to help Beth serve. Standing at the table, his mother read several verses from a tattered old O.C. Bible in a deeply reverent voice. Her goal was to read the entire mammoth tome to her children before she died, and then they sat down to eat. He and his sister talked while sipping a soup of stringy vegetables, seasoned only with salt and a few sprigs of dried herbs. During the meal, Gurney's parents spoke little, usually in monosyllables. Finishing, he carried his dishes to the basin, where he scrubbed them and left them to drip dry for the next day. With wet hands, he clapped his father on the shoulder.
"Are you going to join me at the tavern? It's fellowship night."
The older man shook his head.
"I'd rather sleep. Sometimes your songs just make me feel too tired."
Gurney shrugged.
"Get your rest, then."
In his small room, he opened the rickety wardrobe and took out his most prized possession. An old balisette, designed as a 9-stringed instrument, though Gurney had learned to play with only 7, since 2 strings were broken and he had no replacements. He had found the discarded instrument, damaged and useless, but after working on it patiently for 6 months, sanding, lacquering, shaping parts, the balisette made the sweetest music he'd ever heard, albeit without a full tonal range. Gurney spent hours in the night strumming the strings, spinning the counterbalance wheel. He taught himself to play tunes he had heard, or composed new ones. As darkness enclosed the village, his mother sagged into a chair. She placed the precious Bible in her lap, comforted more by its weight than its words.
"Don't be late," she said in a dry, empty voice.
"I won't."
Gurney wondered if she would notice if he stayed out all night.
"I'll need my strength to tackle those trenches tomorrow."
He raised a well-muscled arm, feigning enthusiasm for the tasks all of them knew would never end. He made his way across the packed dirt streets down to the tavern. In the wake of a deadly fever several years ago, 4 of the prefab structures had been left empty. The villagers had moved the buildings together, knocked down the connecting walls, and fashioned themselves a large community house. Although this wasn't exactly against the numerous Harkonnen restrictions, the local enforcers had frowned at such a display of initiative. But the tavern remained. Gurney joined the small crowd of men who had already gathered for the fellowship down at the tavern. Some brought their wives. One man already lay slumped across the table, more exhausted than drunk, his flagon of watery beer only half consumed. Gurney crept up behind him, held out his balisette, and strummed a jangling chord that startled the man to full wakefulness.
"Here's a new one, friends. Not exactly a hymn that your mothers remember, but I'll teach it to you."
He gave them a wry grin.
"Then you'll all sing along with me, and probably ruin the tune."
None of them were very good singers, but the songs were entertaining, and it brought a measure of brightness to their lives. With full energy, he tacked sardonic words onto a familiar melody.
"O Geedy Prime, thy shades of black are beyond compare, from obsidian plains to oily seas, to the darkest nights in the Emperor's eye.
Come ye from far and wide to see what we hide in our hearts and minds, to share our bounty and lift a pickaxe or two, making it all lovelier than before. O Geedy Prime, thy shades of black are beyond compare, from obsidian plains to oily seas, to the darkest nights in the Emperor's eye."
When Gurney finished the song, he wore a grin on his plain, blocky face and bowed to imagined applause. One of the men called out hoarsely,
"Watch yourself, Gurney Halleck. If the Harkonnens hear your sweet voice, they'll haul you off to Harko for sure, so you can sing for the Baron himself.
Gurney made a rude noise. The Baron has no ear for music, especially not lovely songs like mine. This brought a round of laughter. He picked up a mug of the sour beer and chugged it down. Then the door burst open, and Beth ran in, her flaxen hair loose, her face flushed.
"Patrol coming. We saw the suspensor lights. They've got a prisoner transport and a dozen guards."
The men sat up with a jolt. Two ran for the doors, but the others remained frozen in place, already looking caught and defeated. Gurney strummed a soothing note on his balisette.
"Be calm, my friends. Are we doing anything illegal? The guilty both know and show their crimes. We are merely enjoying fellowship. The Harkonnens can't arrest us for that. In fact, we're demonstrating how much we like our conditions, how happy we are to work for the Baron and his minions. Right, mates?"
A somber grumbling was all the agreement he managed to elicit. Gurney set aside his balisette and went to the trapezoidal window of the communal hall just as a prisoner transport pulled up in the center of the village. Several human forms could be seen in shadow behind the transport's plaza windows, evidence that the Harkonnens had been busy arresting people. All women, it appeared. Though he patted his sister's hand and maintained his good humor for the benefit of the others, Gurney knew the troopers needed few excuses to take more captives. Brilliant spotlights targeted the village. Dark armored forms rushed up the packed dirt streets, pounding on houses. Then the door to the communal building was shouldered open with a loud crash. Six men strode inside. Gurney recognized Captain Kryubi of the Baronial Guard, the man in charge of House Harkonnen's security.
"Stand still for inspection," Kryubi ordered.
A shard of mustache bristled on his lip. His face was narrow and his cheeks looked sunken, as if he clenched his jaw too often. Gurney remained by the window.
"We've done nothing wrong here, Captain. We follow Harkonnen rules. We do our work."
Kryubi looked over at him.
"And who appointed you the leader of this village?"
Gurney did not think fast enough to keep his sarcasm in check.
"And who gave you orders to harass innocent villagers? You'll make us incapable of doing our tasks tomorrow."
His companions in the tavern were horrified at his impudence. Beth clutched Gurney's hand, trying to keep her brother quiet. The Harkonnen guards made threatening gestures with their weapons. Gurney jerked his chin to indicate the prisoner escort vehicle outside the window.
"What did those people do? What crimes worthy of arrest?"
"No crimes are necessary," Kryubi said, coolly unafraid of the truth. Gurney took a step forward, but three guards grasped his arms and threw him heavily to the floor. He knew the Baron often recruited guards from the farming villages. The new thugs, rescued from bleak lives and given new uniforms, weapons, lodgings, and women, often became scornful of their previous lives and proved crueler than off-world professionals. Gurney hoped he would recognize a man from a neighboring village so he could spit in his eye. His head struck the hard floor, but he sprang back to his feet. Beth moved quickly to her brother's side.
"Don't provoke them anymore."
It was the worst thing she could have done. Kryubi pointed at her.
"All right, take that one, too."
Beth's narrow face paled when two of the three guards grabbed her by her thin arms. She struggled as they hauled her to the still-open door. Gurney cast his balisette aside and lunged forward, but the remaining guard produced his weapon and brought the butt down hard across the young man's forehead and nose. Gurney staggered, then threw himself forward again, swinging balled fists like mallets.
"Leave her alone!"
He knocked one of the guards down and tore the second one away from his sister. She screamed as the three converged upon Gurney, pummeling him, slamming their weapons so brutally into him that his ribs cracked. His nose was already bloodied.
"Help me!" Gurney shouted to the saucer-eyed villagers. "We outnumber the bastards!"
No one came to his aid. He flailed and punched, but went down in a flurry of kicking boots and pounding weapons. Struggling to lift his head, he saw Cryubi watching as his men pulled Beth toward the door. Gurney pushed, trying to throw off the heavy men who held him down. Between the gauntleted arms and padded legs, he saw the villagers frozen in their seats like sheep. They watched him with stricken expressions, but remained as motionless as stones in a castle keep.
"Help me, damn you!"
One guard punched him in the solar plexus, making him gasp and retch. Gurney's voice was gone, his breath fading. Black spots danced in front of his eyes. Finally, the guards withdrew. He propped himself on an elbow just in time to see Beth's despairing face as the Harkonnen men dragged her into the night. Enraged and frustrated, he swayed back to his feet, fighting to remain conscious. He heard the prison transport power up in the square outside. Haloed by a glow of illumination against the windows of the tavern, it roared off toward another village to pick up more captives. Gurney blinked at the other men through swollen eyes. Strangers. He coughed and spat blood, then wiped it from his lips. Finally, when he could wheeze, he said,
"You bastards just sat there. You didn't lift a finger to help."
Brushing himself off, he glared at the villagers.
"How can you let them do this to us? They took my sister."
But they were no better than sheep, and never had been. He should have expected nothing different now. With utter contempt, he spat blood and saliva on the floor, then staggered toward the door and out. Secrets are an important aspect of power. The effective leader spreads them in order to keep men in line. Prince Raphael Carino, Discourses on Leadership in a Galactic Imperium, 12th Edition. The ferret-faced man stood like a spying crow on the second level of the residency at Arrakeen. He gazed down into the spacious atrium.
"You are certain they know about our little soiree, well?"
His lips were cracked from the dry air. They had been that way for years. All the invitations personally delivered, all the populace notified. Count Hasimir Fenring leaned toward the slender, loose-chinned chief of his guard force, Geraldo Willowbrook, who stood beside him. The scarlet and gold uniformed man nodded, squinted in the bright light that streamed through prismatic, shield-reinforced windows.
"It will be a grand celebration for your anniversary here, sir. Already beggars are massing at the front gate."
Good, very good. My wife will be pleased."
On the main floor below, a chef carried a silver coffee service toward the kitchen. Cooking odors drifted upward, exotic soups and sauces prepared for the evening's extravagant festivities, broiled brochettes of meat from animals that had never lived on Arrakis. Fenring gripped a carved ironwood banister. An arched Gothic ceiling rose two stories overhead, with a lock of wood crossbeams and plaz skylights. Though muscular, he was not a large man, and found himself dwarfed by the immensity of this house. He'd commissioned the ceiling himself, and another in the dining hall. The new east wing was his concept as well, with its elegant guest rooms and opulent private pools. In his decade as Imperial Observer on the desert planet, he had generated a constant buzz of construction around him. Following his exile from Shaddam's court on Catane, he'd had to make his mark somehow. From the botanical conservatory under construction near the private chambers he shared with Lady Margot, He heard the hum of power tools along with the chants of day labor crews. They cut keyhole-arched doorways, set dry fountains into alcoves, adorned walls with colorful geometric mosaics. For luck, one of the hinges supporting a heavy ornamental door had been symbolically shaped as the hand of Fatima, beloved daughter of an ancient prophet of old Terra. Fenring was about to dismiss Willowbrook when a resounding crash made the upper floor shudder. The two men ran down the curving hallway past bookcases. From rooms and lift tubes, curious household servants poked their heads into the corridor. The oval conservatory door stood open, revealing a mass of tangled metal and plaz. One of the workers shouted for medics over the din of screaming. A fully laden suspensor scaffold had collapsed. Fenring vowed to personally administer the appropriate punishment once an investigation had pointed fingers at the likely scapegoats. Shouldering his way into the room, Fenring looked up. Through the open metal framing of the arched roof, he saw a lemon-yellow sky. Only a few of the filter glass windows had been installed. Others now lay shattered in the tangle of scaffolding. He spoke in a tone of disgust. "Unfortunate timing, I was going to take our guests on a tour tonight." "Yes, most unfortunate, Count Fenring, sir." Willowbrook watched while household workers began digging in the rubble to reach the injured. House medics in khaki uniforms hurried past him into the ruined area. One tended a bloody-faced man who had just been pulled from the debris, while two men helped remove a heavy sheet of plaz from additional victims. The job superintendent had been crushed by the fallen scaffold. "Stupid fellow," Fenring thought. "But lucky, considering what I'd have done to him for this mess." Fenring glanced at his wrist chron. 2 more hours until the guests arrived. He motioned to Willowbrook. "Wrap it up here. I don't want any noise coming from this area during the party. That would provide entirely the wrong message. Lady Margot and I have laid out the evening's festivities most carefully, down to the last detail." Willowbrook scowled, but obviously thought better of showing defiance. "It will be done, sir, in less than an hour." Fenring simmered. In reality, he cared nothing for exotic plants, and initially had agreed to this expensive remodeling only as a concession to his Bene Gesserit wife, the Lady Margot. Although she'd requested only a modest airlocked room with plants inside, Fenring, ever ambitious, had expanded it to something far more impressive. He conceived plans to collect rare flora from all over the Imperium. If ever the conservatory could be finished. Composing himself, he greeted Margot in the vaulted entry just as she returned from the labyrinthine souk markets in town. A willowy blonde with gray-green eyes, perfect figure and impeccable features, she stood nearly a head taller than he. She wore an abba robe tailored to show off her figure, the black fabric speckled with dust from the streets. "Did they have ikazi turnips, my dear?" The Count stared hungrily at 2 heavy packages wrapped in thick brown spice paper carried by male servants. Having heard of a merchant's arrival by Highliner that afternoon, Margot had hurried into Erekine to purchase the scarce vegetables. He tried to peek under the paper wrappings, but she playfully slapped his hand away. "Is everything ready here, my dear?" "It's all going smoothly," he said. "We can't tour your new conservatory tonight, though. It's too messy up there for our dinner guests." Waiting to greet the important guests as they arrived at sunset, Lady Margot Fenring stood in the mansion's atrium, adorned on its wood-paneled lower level with portraits of Padishah emperors extending back to the legendary General Faycon Corrin, who had fought in the Butlerian Jihad, and the enlightened ruler Crown Prince Raphael Carino, as well as the hunter Fondil the Third, and his son, Elrud the Ninth. In the center of the atrium, a golden statue showed the current Emperor Shaddam the Fourth in full Sardaukar regalia with a ceremonial sword raised high. It was one of many expensive works the Emperor had commissioned in the first decade of his reign. Around the residency and grounds were numerous additional examples, gifts from her husband's boyhood friend. Although the two men had quarreled at the time of Shaddam's ascension to the throne, they had gradually grown closer again. Through the dust-sealed double doors streamed elegantly dressed ladies, accompanied by men in raven-like post-butlerian tuxedos and military uniforms of varying colors. Margot herself wore a floor-length gown of silk taffeta with emerald shimmer sequins on the bodice. As a uniformed crier announced her guests, Margot greeted them. They filed past into the grand hall, where she heard much laughter, conversation, and clinking of glasses. Entertainers from House Jongleur performed tricks and sang witty songs to celebrate the Fenring's 10 years on Arrakis. Her husband strutted down the grand staircase from the second floor. Count Fenring wore a dark blue retro tuxedo with a crimson royal sash across the chest, personally tailored for him on Bikfar. She bent to allow the shorter man to kiss her on the lips. "Now go in and welcome our guests, dear, before the Baron dominates every conversation." With a light step, Fenring avoided an intent, frumpy-looking duchess from one of the Carino subplanets. The duchess passed a remote-cast poison snooper over her wine glass before drinking, then slipped the device unobtrusively into a pocket of her ball gown. Margot watched her husband as he went to the fireplace to talk with Baron Harkonnen, current holder of the Cyrodiil fief of Arrakis and its rich spice monopoly. The light of a blazing fire enhanced by hearth prisms gave the Baron's puffy features an eerie cast. He wasn't looking at all well. In the years she and Fenring had been stationed there, the Baron had invited them to dine at his keep or attend gladiatorial events featuring slaves from Gedi Prime. He was a dangerous man who thought too much of himself. Now, the Baron leaned on a gilded walking stick whose head had been designed to resemble the mouth of a great sandworm of Arrakis. Margot had seen the Baron's health decline dramatically over the past decade. He suffered from a mysterious muscular and neurological malady that had caused him to gain weight. From her Bene Gesserit sisters, she knew the reason for his physical discomfiture, how it had been inflicted upon him when he'd raped Reverend Mother Gaius Helen Mohiam. The Baron, however, had never learned the cause of his distress. Mohiam herself, another carefully selected guest for this event, passed into Margot's line of sight. The gray-haired Reverend Mother wore a formal abba robe with a diamond-crusted collar. She smiled a tight-lipped greeting. With a subtle flicker of fingers, she sent a message and a question. "What news for Mother Superior Harishka? Give details. I must report to her." Margot's fingers responded. "Progress on the Missionaria Protectiva matter. Only rumors, nothing confirmed. Missing sisters not yet located. Long time. They may all be dead." Mohiam did not look pleased. She herself had once worked with the Missionaria Protectiva, an invaluable Bene Gesserit division that sowed infectious superstitions on far-flung worlds. Mohiam had spent decades here in her younger years, posing as a town woman, disseminating information, enhancing superstitions that might benefit the sisterhood. Mohiam herself had never been able to infiltrate the closed Fremen society, but over the centuries, many other sisters had gone into the deep desert to mingle with the Fremen, and had disappeared. Since she was on Arrakis as the Count's consort, Margot had been asked to confirm the Missionaria's subtle work. Thus far, she'd heard unconfirmed reports of Reverend Mothers who had joined the Fremen and gone underground, as well as rumors of Bene Gesserit-like religious rituals among the tribes. One isolated CH supposedly had a holy woman. Dusty travelers were overheard in a town coffee tent speaking of a messiah legend clearly inspired by the Panoplia Propheticus. But none of this information came directly from the Fremen themselves. The desert people, like their planet, seemed impenetrable. Maybe the Fremen murdered the Bene Gesserit women outright and stole the water from their bodies. Those others have been swallowed up by the sands. Margot's fingers flickered. Nevertheless, find them. With a nod that ended the silent conversation, Mohiam glided across the room toward a side doorway.
Rondo Tuic, the crier announced. The water merchant.
Turning, Margot saw a broad-faced but wiry man stride across the foyer with an odd rolling gait. He had tufts of rusty gray hair at the sides of his head, thinning strands on his pate, and widely separated gray eyes. She reached out to greet him.
Ah, yes, the smuggler.
Tuic's flat cheeks darkened, then a broad smile cracked his squarish face. He wagged a finger at her in the manner of a teacher to a student.
I am a water supplier who works hard to excavate moisture from the dirty ice caps. Without the industriousness of your family, I'm sure the Imperium would collapse.
My lady is too kind. Tuic bowed and entered the grand hall. Outside the residency, poor beggars had gathered, hoping for a rare show of graciousness from the Count. Other spectators had come to watch the beggars and gaze longingly up at the ornate facade of the mansion. Water sellers in brightly dyed traditional garb jingled their bells and called out an eerie cry of Su-su-suk! Guards, borrowed from the Harkonnen troops and obliged to wear imperial uniforms for the event, stood by the doorways, keeping out undesirables and clearing the way for the invited. It was a circus. When the last of the expected guests arrived, Margot glanced at an antique chrono set into the wall, adorned with mechanical figures and delicate chimes. They were nearly half an hour late. She hurried to her husband's side and whispered in his ear. He dispatched a messenger to the jongleurs, and they fell silent, a signal familiar to the guests.
"May I have your attention, please, Fenring shouted. Pompously dressed footmen appeared to escort the attendees. We will reconvene in the dining hall. According to tradition, Count and Countess Fenring trailed behind the last of their guests.
On either side of the wide doorway to the dining hall stood laving basins of gold-embedded tile, decorated with intricate mosaics containing the crests of House Carino and House Harkonnen, in accordance with political necessity. The crest denoting the previous governors of Arrakis, House Richesi, had been painstakingly chiseled out to be replaced with a blue Harkonnen griffin. The guests paused at the basins, dipped their hands into the water, and slopped some onto the floor. After drying their hands, they flung towels into a growing puddle. Baron Harkonnen had suggested this custom to show that a planetary governor cared nothing for water shortages. It was an optimistic flaunting of wealth. Fenring had liked the sound of that, and the procedure had been instituted. With a benevolent twist, however, Lady Margot saw a way to help the beggars in a largely symbolic way. With her husband's grudging concurrence, she let it be known that at the conclusion of each banquet, beggars were welcome to gather outside the mansion and receive any water that could be squeezed from the soiled towels. Her hands tingling and damp, Margot entered the long hall with her husband. Antique tapestries adorned the walls. Free-floating glow globes wandered around the room, all set at the same height above the floor, all tuned to the yellow band. Over the polished wooden table hung a chandelier of glittering blue-green Hegel quartz, with a sensitive poison snooper concealed in the upper reaches of the chain. A small army of footmen held chairs for the diners and draped a napkin over each guest's lap. Someone stumbled and knocked a crystal centerpiece to the floor, where it shattered. Servants hurried to clean it up and replace it. Everyone else pretended not to notice. Margot, seated at the foot of the long table, nodded graciously to planetologist Pardo Kynes and his 12-year-old son, who took their assigned seats on either side of her. She'd been surprised when the rarely seen desert man accepted her invitation, and she hoped to learn how many of the rumors about him were true. In her experience, dinner parties were notorious for small talk and insincerity, though certain things did not escape the attention of an astute Bene Gesserit observer. She watched the lean man carefully, noting a repair patch on the gray collar of his dress tunic and the strong line of his sandy, bearded jaw. Two places down from her, Reverend Mother Mohiam slid into a chair. Hasimir Fenring took his seat at the head of the table, with Baron Harkonnen on his right. Knowing how the Baron and Mohiam loathed one another, Margot had seated them far apart. At a snap of Fenring's fingers, servants bearing platters of exotic morsels emerged from side doorways. They worked their way around the table, identifying the fare and serving sample portions from the plates.
"Thank you for inviting us, Lady Fenring," Kynes's son said, looking at Margot.
The planetologist had introduced the young man as Weichi, a name that meant beloved. She could see a resemblance to the father, but while the older Kynes had a dreaminess in his eyes, this Weichi bore a hardness caused by growing up on Arrakis. She smiled at him.
"One of our chefs is a city Fremen who has prepared a CH specialty for the banquet, spice cakes with honey and sesame."
"Fremen cuisine is imperial class, no?" Pardo Kynes inquired with a wry smile. He looked as if he'd never thought of food as anything more than sustenance, and considered formal dining to be a distraction from other work.
"Cuisine is a matter of taste."
She selected her words diplomatically. Her eyes twinkled.
"I take that as a no," he said.
Tall off-world serving women moved from place to place with narrow-necked bottles of blue melange-laced wine. To the amazement of the locals, plates of whole fish appeared, surrounded by gaping boozal mussels. Even the wealthiest inhabitants of Arrakeen rarely sampled seafood.
"Ah,"
Fenring said with delight from the other end of the table, as a servant lifted a cover from a tray.
"I shall relish these ikazi turnips. Thank you, my dear."
The servant ladled dark sauce onto the vegetables.
"No expense is too great for our honored guests," Margot said.
"Let me tell you why those vegetables are so expensive," a diplomat from Ikaz groused, commanding everyone's attention. Bindik Narvi was a small man with a deep, thundering voice. "Crop sabotage has drastically reduced our supply for the entire Imperium. We've named this new scourge the Grumman Blight."
He glared across the table at the ambassador from Grumman, a huge, heavy-drinking man with creased dark skin.
"We have also discovered biological sabotage in our fog tree forests on the continent of Elaka."
All of the Imperium-prized Ikazi fog tree sculptures, which were made by directing growth through the power of human thought. Despite his bulk, the Mauritani man, Lupino Ord, spoke in a squeaky voice.
"Once again, the Ikazis fake a shortage to drive prices up, an ancient trick that has been around since your thieving ancestors were driven from old Terra in disgrace."
"That isn't what happened at all."
"Gentlemen, please," Fenring said.
The Grummans had always been a very volatile people, ready to fly into a vengeful frenzy at the slightest perceived insult. Fenring found it all rather thin-skinned and boring. He looked at his wife.
"Did we make a mistake in the seating arrangement, my dear? Or perhaps in the guest list?" she quipped. Polite, embarrassed laughter bubbled around the table. The quarreling men grew quiet, though they glared at one another.
"So nice to see that our eminent planetologist has brought along his fine young son," Baron Harkonnen said in an oily tone. "Quite a handsome lad. You have the distinction of being the youngest dinner guest."
"I am honored to be here," the boy replied, "among such esteemed company."
"Being groomed to succeed your father, I hear," the Baron continued. Margot detected carefully hidden sarcasm in the basso voice. "I don't know what we'd do without a planetologist."
In truth, Kynes was rarely seen in the city, and almost never submitted the required reports to the Emperor, not that Shaddam noticed or cared. Margot had gleaned from her husband that the Emperor was occupied with other, as yet unrevealed, matters. The young man's intent eyes brightened. He raised a water flagon.
"May I propose a toast to our host and hostess?"
Pardo Kynes blinked at his son's boldness, as if surprised that the social nicety had not occurred to him first.
"An excellent suggestion," the Baron gushed. Margot recognized a slackness in his speech from consuming too much melange wine.
The 12-year-old spoke in a firm voice before taking a sip.
"May the wealth you display for us here, with all this food and abundance of water, be merely a pale reflection of the riches in your hearts."
The assembled guests endorsed the blessing, and Margot detected a flicker of greed in their eyes. The planetologist fidgeted and finally spoke what was on his mind, as the clinking of glasses diminished.
"Count Fenring, I understand you have an elaborate wet planet conservatory under construction here. I would be very interested in seeing it."
Margot suddenly understood why Kynes had accepted the invitation, the reason he had come in from the desert. Dressed in his plain but serviceable tunic and breeches, covered by a sandy brown cloak, the man resembled a dirty Fremen more than an imperial servant.
"You have learned our little secrets,
With obvious discomfort, Fenring pursed his lips.
"I had intended to show it to my guests this evening, but sadly certain delays have made that impossible. Some other time, perhaps."
"By keeping a private conservatory, do you not flaunt things that the people of Arrakis cannot have?"
young Weichi asked.
"Yet,"
Pardo Kynes said under his breath. Margot heard it.
Interesting.
She saw that it would be a mistake to underestimate this rugged man, or even his son.
"Surely it is an admirable goal to collect plants from all over the Imperium," she suggested patiently.
"I see it as a display of riches the universe has to offer, rather than a reminder of what the people lack."
In a low but firm tone, Pardo Kynes admonished the young man,
"We did not come here to force our views on others."
"On the contrary, please be so good as to explain your views," Margot urged, trying to ignore insulting looks still being exchanged across the table by the Ikazi and Grumman ambassadors.
"We won't take offense, I promise you."
"Yes," said a Carthag weapons importer from halfway down the table. His fingers were so laden with jeweled rings he could barely lift his hands. "Explain how Fremen think. We all want to know that."
Kynes nodded slowly.
"I have lived with them for many years. To begin an understanding of the Fremen, realize that survival is their mindset. They waste nothing. Everything is salvaged, reused,
down to the last drop of water," Fenring said. "Even the water in dead bodies,
Kynes looked at his son, then back at Margot. "And your private conservatory will require a great deal of that precious water to maintain."
"Ah, but as Imperial Observer here, I can do anything I please with natural resources," Fenring pointed out. "I consider my wife's conservatory a worthwhile expenditure."
"Your rights are not in doubt," Kynes said, his tone as steady as the shield wall. "And I am the planetologist for Emperor Shaddam, as I was for Elrud the Ninth before him. We are each bound to our duties, Count Fenring. You will hear no speeches from me about ecological issues. I merely answered your lady's question."
"Well then, planetologist, tell us something we don't know about Arrakis," the Baron said, gazing down the table. "You've certainly been here long enough. More of my men die here than in any other Harkonnen holding. The Guild can't even put enough functional weather satellites in orbit to provide reliable surveillance and make predictions. It is most frustrating."
"And thanks to the spice, Arrakis is also profitable," Margot said. "Especially for you, dear Baron."
"This planet defies understanding," Kynes said, "and it will take more than my brief lifetime to determine what is going on here. This much I know. We must learn how to live with the desert, rather than against it."
"Do the Fremen hate us?" Duchess Caller, an Imperial cousin, asked. She held a forkful of brandy-seasoned sweetbreads halfway to her mouth.
"They are insular, and distrust anyone who is non-Fremen. But they are honest, direct people with a code of honor that no one at this table, not even myself, fully understands."
With an elegant lift of her eyebrows, Margot asked the next question, watching carefully for his reaction.
"Is it true what we've heard? That you've become one of them yourself, planetologist?"
"I remain an Imperial servant, my lady, though there is much to be learned from the Fremen."
Murmurs rose from different seats, accompanied by louder pockets of discussion while the first dessert course arrived.
"Our Emperor still has no heir," Lupino Ord, the Grumman ambassador, commented.
The big man's voice was a lilting shrill. He'd been drinking steadily.
"Only two daughters, Irulan and Chalice. Not that women aren't valuable."
He looked around mischievously with his coal-black eyes, catching the disapproving gazes of several ladies at the table.
"But without a male heir, House Carina must step aside in favor of another great house."
"If he lives as long as Elrud, our Emperor might have a century left in him," Margot pointed out. "Perhaps you haven't heard that Lady Anarul is with child again."
"My duties sometimes keep me out of the mainstream of news," Ord admitted.
He lifted his wine glass.
"Let us hope the next one is a boy."
"Hear, hear," several diners called out.
But the Ikazi diplomat, Bindik Narvi, made an obscene hand gesture. Margot had heard about the long-standing animosity between the Archduke Armand de Cals and Viscount Moritani of Grumman, but hadn't realized how serious it had grown. She wished she hadn't seated the two rivals so close to one another. Ord grabbed a thin-necked bottle and poured more blue wine for himself before a servant could do it for him.
"Count Fenring, you have many works of art featuring our Emperor. Paintings, statues, plaques bearing his likeness. Is Shaddam funneling too much money into such self-serving commissions? They have sprouted up all over the Imperium."
"And someone keeps defacing them or knocking them down," the Carthag weapons importer said with a snort.
Thinking of the planetologist and his son next to her, Margot selected a sweet melange cake from the dessert tray. Perhaps the guests had not heard the other rumors,
that those benevolent gifts of artwork contained surveillance devices to monitor activities around the Imperium, such as the plaque on the wall, right behind Ord. Shaddam desires to make his mark as our ruler, Fenring commented. I have known him for many years. He wishes to separate himself from the policies of his father, who served for so interminably long. Perhaps, but he's neglecting the training of actual Sardaukar troops, while allowing the ranks of his generals... What are they called?
Bursegs, someone said.
Yes, while allowing the ranks of his Bursegs to increase with exorbitant pensions and other benefits. Morale among the Sardaukar must be ebbing, as they are called upon to do more with fewer and fewer resources.
Margot noticed her husband had grown dangerously quiet. Having narrowed his large eyes to slits, he was staring at the foolish drunk. A woman whispered something to the Grumman ambassador. He ran a finger over the lip of his wine glass.
Oh, yes. I apologize for stating the obvious to someone who knows our emperor so well.
You're an idiot, Ord, Narvi thundered, as if he'd been waiting for any chance to shout an insult.
And you're a fool and a dead man.
The Grumman ambassador stood up, knocking his chair over behind him. He moved too swiftly, too accurately. Had his drunkenness all been an act, an excuse just to provoke the man? Lupino Ord drew a gleaming cutter disc pistol and, with ear-piercing reports, fired it repeatedly at his adversary. Had he planned this, provoking his Ikazi rival? Cutter discs tore Narvi's face and chest apart, killing him long before the poisons on the razor edges could have any effect. Diners cried out and scattered in all directions. Footmen grabbed the reeling ambassador and wrestled the expended weapon from him. Margot sat frozen in place, more astonished than terrified.
What have I missed? How deep does this animosity between Ikaz and House Moritani go?
Lock him in one of the underground tunnels, Fenring commanded. Station a guard at all times.
But I have diplomatic immunity, Ord protested, his voice squeakier now. You don't dare hold me.
Never assume. What I might dare.
The Count glanced at the shocked faces around him. I could simply allow my other guests to punish you, thus exercising their own... immunity? Fenring waved an arm, and the sputtering man was taken away until protected passage back to Grumman could be arranged. Medics hurried in, the same ones Fenring had seen earlier at the conservatory disaster. Clearly, they could do nothing for the mutilated Ikazi ambassador.
Quite a body count around here today, Fenring mused. And I didn't kill any of them.
He said to his wife, who stood by him. I fear this will become an incident. Archduke Ikaz is bound to issue a formal complaint. And there's no telling how Viscount Moritani will respond.
He commanded the footman to remove Narvi's body from the hall. Many of the guests had scattered to other rooms of the mansion.
Shall we call people back?
He squeezed his wife's hand. I hate to see the evening end like this.
Maybe we could bring in the jongleurs, have them tell amusing stories.
Baron Harkonnen came up beside them, leaning on his worm-head cane.
This is your jurisdiction, Count Fenring, not mine. You send a report to the Emperor.
I'll take care of it, Fenring said tersely.
I'm journeying to Catane on another matter, and I will provide Shaddam with the necessary details.
And the proper excuses...
In the days of old Terra, there were experts in poisons, deviously clever persons who dealt in what were known as the powders of inheritance. Film book excerpt. Royal Library of Catane. Grinning with pride, Court Chamberlain Billy Redondo marched through the doorway. "Your Imperial Majesty, you have another new daughter. Your wife has just delivered a fine and healthy girl." Instead of rejoicing, Emperor Shaddam IV cursed under his breath and sent the man away. "That makes three. What use is another daughter to me?" He was in a foul mood, worse than any since the struggles to remove his decrepit father from the Golden Lion throne. At a brisk pace, Shaddam entered his private study, passing beneath an ancient plaque that read, "Law is the ultimate science." Some nonsense from Crown Prince Raphael Carino, a man who'd never even bothered to wear the imperial crown. He sealed the door behind him and thumped his angular frame into the textured, high-backed suspensor chair at his desk. A man of middle height, Shaddam had a loosely muscled body and an aquiline nose. His long nails were carefully manicured, his pomaded red hair combed straight back. He wore a gray Sardaukar-style uniform with epaulets and silver and gold trim, but the military trappings no longer comforted him as they once had. In addition to the birth of yet another daughter, he had much on his mind. Recently, at a gala concert in one of the inverted pyramid stadiums on Harmonthep, someone had released a giant inflated effigy of Shaddam IV. Obscenely insulting, the gaudy caricature made him look like a buffoon. The inflatable construction had drifted over the vast, laughing crowds until the Harmonthep dragoon guards had shot it down in flaming tatters, and any fool could see the symbolism in that act. Despite the most rigorous crackdown and interrogation, even Sardaukar investigators were not able to determine who'd been responsible for creating or releasing the effigy. In another incident, 100-meter-high letters had been scrawled across the granite wall of Monument Canyon on Kanadar 2. "Shaddam, does your crown rest comfortably on your pointy head?" In scattered worlds across the Imperium, dozens of his new commemorative statues had been defaced. Nobody had ever seen the perpetrators. Someone hated him enough to do this. Someone. The question kept gnawing at his imperial heart, along with other worries, including an impending visit from Hazimir Fenring to report on the secret synthetic spice experiments being conducted by the Tleiloxu. Project Amal. Initiated during his father's reign, this research was known to only a few. Perhaps the most closely guarded secret in the Imperium, Project Amal could, if successful, give House Carino a reliable, artificial source of melange, the most precious substance in the universe. But the damned Tleiloxu experiments were taking years too long, and the situation upset him more and more with each passing month. And now, a third cursed daughter. He didn't know when or if he would bother to gaze upon this useless new girl child. Shaddam's gaze moved along the paneled wall to a bookcase that contained a stand-up holophoto of Anarule in her wedding gown, shelved next to a thick reference volume of great historical disasters. She had large doe eyes, hazel in some light, darker at other times, that concealed something. He should have noticed before. It was the third time this Bene Gesserit of hidden rank had failed to produce the required male heir, and Shaddam had made no contingency plans for such an eventuality. His face grew hot. He could always impregnate a few concubines and hope for a son, but while legally married to Anarule, he would face tremendous political difficulties if he attempted to declare a bastard his heir for the imperial throne. He could also kill Anarule and take another wife. His father had done that enough times. but such a course of action would risk the wrath of the Bene Gesserit sisterhood. Everything could be solved if Anarul would just give him a son, a healthy male child he could call his heir. All these months of waiting, and now this. He'd heard that the witches could actually choose the gender of their children through manipulations in body chemistry. These daughters could be no accident. He'd been deceived by the Bene Gesserit power brokers who had foisted Anarul on him. How dare they do that to the Emperor of a million worlds? What was Anarul's true purpose in his royal household? Was she gathering blackmail information to use against him? Should he send her away? He tapped a stylus on his blood-grained Ilaka wood desk, stared at an image of his paternal grandfather, Fondil III, commonly known as the Hunter for his propensity to attack every vestige of rebellion. Fondil had been no less feared in his own household. Though the old man had died long before Shaddam's birth, he knew something of the Hunter's moods and methods. Had Fondil been faced with an arrogant wife, he would have found a way to rid himself of her. Shaddam pressed a button on his desk, and his personal chamberlain re-entered the study. Redondo bowed, showing the gleaming top of his high forehead.
"Sire?"
"I wish to see Anarul now. Here."
"The lady is in bed, sire."
"Don't make me repeat my order." Without another word, Redondo faded into the woodwork, disappearing through the side door with long, spidery movements. Moments later, a pale and overly perfumed lady-in-waiting arrived. In a shaky voice, she said,
"My Emperor, the Lady Anarul wishes me to convey that she is weakened from the birth of your child. She begs your indulgence in permitting her to remain in bed. Might it be possible for you to consider coming to visit her and the baby?"
"I see. She begs my indulgence. I am not interested in seeing another useless daughter or in hearing further excuses. This is a command from your Emperor. Anarul is to come here now. She is to do it alone, without the aid of any servant or mechanical device. Is that understood?" With any luck, she would drop dead along the way. Terrified, the lady-in-waiting bowed.
"As you wish, sire."
Presently, a gray-skinned Anarul stood in the doorway of his private study, holding tight to the fluted support column. She wore a wrinkled scarlet and gold robe that did not entirely conceal the nightclothes underneath. Though swaying on her feet, she held her head high. "What do you have to say for yourself?" he demanded.
"I've just had a difficult childbirth, and I'm quite weak."
"Excuses, excuses. You are intelligent enough to figure out what I mean. You've been clever enough to fool me all these years."
"Fool you?" She blinked her doe eyes at him as if he were out of his mind. "Forgive me, Majesty, but I am tired. Why must you be so cruel, calling me here like this and refusing to see our daughter?"
His lips were colorless, as if the blood had drained from them. His eyes were flat pools. "Because you could give me a male heir, but refuse to do so."
"There is no truth in that, Majesty. Only rumors."
It required all of her Bene Gesserit training to remain standing. "I listen to intelligence reports, not rumors." The Emperor peered at her through one open eye, as if he could see her in more minute detail that way. "Do you wish to die, Anarul?" It occurred to Anarul that he might kill her after all.
"There is certainly no love between us.
But would he dare risk the Sisterhood's ire by disposing of me?" At the time of his ascension to the throne, Shaddam had agreed to marry her because he'd needed the strength of a Bene Gesserit alliance in the uneasy political climate. Now, after a dozen years,
Shaddam felt too confident in his position. "Everyone dies," she said. "But not the way I could arrange for you." Anarul tried not to show emotion and reminded herself that she was not alone, that within her psyche were the collective memories of the multitudes of Bene Gesserit who had come before her and remained in other memory. Her voice was utterly calm. "We are not the complex, devious witches we are made out to be." This was not true, of course, though she knew Shaddam couldn't possibly have more than suspicions to the contrary. His demeanor didn't soften. "What's more important to you? Your sisters or me?" She shook her head in dismay.
"You have no right to ask me such a thing. I've never given you any reason to feel I've been less than faithful to the crown."
Lifting her head proudly, Anarul reminded herself of her position in the long history of the Sisterhood. She would never admit to him that she had orders from the Bene Gesserit hierarchy never to give birth to a Carino son. The wisdom of her sisters echoed through her mind.
"Love weakens. It is dangerous, for it clouds reason and diverts us from our duties. It is an aberration, a disgrace, an unforgivable infraction. We cannot love."
Anarul tried to divert Shaddam's anger.
"Accept your daughter, sire, for she can be used to cement important political alliances. We should discuss her name. What do you think of Wensisia?"
With sudden alarm, she became aware of warm moisture on her inner thighs.
Blood?
Had the stitches broken? Red droplets were falling onto the carpet. Anarul saw him peering down at her feet. New rage consumed the Emperor's features. "That carpet has been in my family for centuries."
"Don't show weakness. He's an animal. We'll attack weakness and back down from strength."
She turned slowly, allowing several more drops to fall, then staggered away.
"Given the history of House Carino, I am certain that blood has been spilled on it before."
It is said that there is nothing firm, nothing balanced, nothing durable in all the universe, that nothing remains in its original state, that each day, each hour, each moment, there is change. Panoplia Propheticus of the Bene Gesserit. On the rugged shore beneath Castle Caladan, a lone figure stood at the end of a long dock, profiled against the sea and the newly risen sun. He had a narrow, olive-skinned face with a high-bridged nose, giving him the look of a hawk. Out on the water, a fleet of fishing coracles was just departing, trailing wakes behind them. Men in heavy sweaters, coats, and knit hats scrambled about on the cluttered decks, preparing their gear for the day. In the village downshore, wisps of smoke rose above the chimneys. Locals called it Old Town, the site of the original settlement centuries before the elegant capital city and spaceport were built on the plain behind the castle. Duke Leto Atreides, dressed casually in blue fishing dungarees and a white tunic with a red hawk crest, took a deep breath of invigorating salt air. Though he was master of House Atreides, representing Caladan to the Landsrod and the Emperor, Leto liked to rise early with the fishermen, many of whom he knew on a first-name basis. Sometimes they invited the Duke to their homes, and despite the objections of his security commander, Thufir Hawat, who trusted no one, he occasionally joined them for a fine meal of chiapino. The salt wind picked up, whipping the sea into dancing whitecaps. He wished he could accompany the men, but his responsibilities were too great here, and there were matters of importance beyond his world as well. He owed allegiance to the Imperium as well as the people he ruled, and he found himself thrust into the middle of great things.
The shocking murder of an Ikazi diplomat by a Grumman ambassador was no small matter, even on distant Arrakis. But Viscount Moritani didn't seem to care about public opinion. Already the great houses were calling for imperial intervention in order to avoid a larger conflict. The day before, Leto had sent his own message to the Landsraad Council on Catane, volunteering his services as a mediator. He was only 26 years old, but a veteran of a decade at the helm of a great house. He attributed his success to the fact that he had never lost touch with his roots. For that, he could thank his late father, Paulus. Ostensibly, the old duke had been an unpretentious man who mixed with his people, just as Duke Leto did now. But his father must have known, though he'd never admitted it to Leto, that this was also a good political tactic, one that endeared the duke to his people. The requirements of the office made for a complex mixture. Sometimes Leto couldn't tell where his personal and official personas began and left off. Shortly after being thrust into his responsibilities, Leto Atreides had stunned the Landsraad with his dramatic trial by forfeiture, a bold gamble to escape being framed for an attack on two Tleiloxu ships inside a guild highliner. Leto's gambit had impressed many of the great houses, and he'd even received a congratulatory letter from Hundra Moritani, the puckish and unlikable Viscount of Grumman, who often refused to cooperate or even participate in matters of the Imperium. The Viscount said he admired Leto's brash flouting of the rules, proving that leadership is made by strong men with strong convictions, not clerks who study commas on law slates. Leto wasn't entirely sure that Moritani believed in his innocence. Instead, he thought the Viscount simply enjoyed seeing Duke Atreides get away unpunished against such insurmountable odds. On the other side of the dispute, Leto had a connection to House Ikaz as well. The old duke, his father, had been one of the great heroes in the Ikazi revolt, battling beside Dominic Vernius to overthrow violent secessionists and defend the Landsraad-sanctioned rulers of the forested world. Paulus Atreides himself had stood beside the grateful young Archduke Armand Ikaz during the victory ceremony that restored him to the Mahogany throne. Somewhere among the old duke's possessions lay the chain of bravery that Armand Ikaz had placed around Paulus's thick neck. And the lawyers who had represented Leto during his Landsraad trial had come from the Ikazi region of Alaka. Since he was respected by both parties in the feud, Leto thought he might make them see a way to peace. Politics. His father had always taught him to be careful to consider the whole picture, from the tiniest to the largest elements. From his tunic pocket, Leto brought out a voice scriber and dictated a letter to his cousin, Shaddam IV, congratulating him on the joyous birth of another child. The message would be sent by official courier on the next guild highliner departing for Catane. When Leto could no longer hear the putt-putting of the fishing boats, he hiked up the steep zigzag path that led to the top of the cliff. He shared a breakfast in the courtyard with 20-year-old Duncan Idaho. The round-faced young man wore a green and black Atreides trooper uniform. His wiry dark hair had been cropped short out of his eyes for vigorous weapons training. Thufir Hawit had spent a lot of time with him, proclaiming him to be a particularly skilled student. But Duncan had already reached the limits of what the warrior Mentat could teach him. As a boy, he had escaped from Harkonnen bondage to Castle Caladan, where he'd thrown himself upon the mercy of the old duke. As he grew up, Duncan remained one of the most loyal members of the Atreides household, and certainly the best weapons trainee. Long-time military allies of House Atreides, the Swordmasters of Ganaz had recently granted Duncan Idaho admission into their renowned academy. "I will be sorry to see you go, Duncan," Leto told him. 8 years is a long time." Duncan sat straight, showing no fear. "But when I return, my duke, I will be better able to serve you in all ways. I'll still be young, and no one will dare threaten you." "Oh,
They'll still threaten me, Duncan. Make no mistake about that.
The young man paused before giving him a thin, hard smile. Then they will be making the mistake, not me. He lifted a slice of peridan melon to his mouth, took a bite of the yellow fruit, and wiped away the salty juice that ran down his chin. I am going to miss these melons. Barracks food can't compare. He cut his portion into smaller sections. Bougainvillea vines trailed up the stone walls around them, but it was still winter and the plants were flowerless. With unseasonable warmth and predictions of an early spring, though, buds had already begun to appear on trees. Leto gave a contented sigh.
I've seen no more beautiful place in all the vast reaches of the Imperium than Caladan in the spring.
Certainly, Gidi Prime can't compare. Duncan raised his guard, uneasy to see how relaxed and content Leto appeared. We must remain constantly on the alert, my Duke, not permitting the slightest weakness. Never forget the ancient feud between Atreides and Harkonnen.
Now you sound like Thufir.
Leto scooped up a sweet mouthful of his pundi rice pudding.
I'm sure there is no finer man than you in the service of the Atreides, Duncan. But I fear we may be creating a monster in sending you away for 8 years of training. What will you be when you return?
Pride infused the young man's deeply set blue-green eyes.
I will be a swordmaster of the Ganaz.
For a long moment, Leto thought of the extreme dangers at the school. Nearly a third of all students died during training. Duncan had laughed off the statistics, saying he had already survived far worse odds against the Harkonnens. And he was right.
I know you will succeed, Leto said. He felt a thickness in his throat, a deep sadness at letting Duncan go. But you must never forget compassion. No matter what you learn, don't come back here with the attitude that you're better than other men.
I won't, my Duke. Leto reached under the table and brought out a long, thin parcel and passed it across the table.
This is why I asked you to join me for breakfast.
Surprised, Duncan opened it and removed an ornately carved ceremonial sword. He gripped the inlaid rope pattern of the pommel.
The old Duke's sword. You're lending it to me?
Giving it to you, my friend. Remember when I found you in the weapons hall, just after my father died in the bull ring? You had taken this sword from the display rack. It was nearly as tall as you were then. But now you've grown into it. Duncan could find no words to thank him.
Leto looked the young man up and down, appraising him.
I believe if my father had lived to see the man you've become, he might have given it to you himself. You're grown now, Duncan Idaho, worthy of a duke's sword.
Good morning, a cheerful voice said. Prince Rombervernius sauntered into the courtyard, still bleary-eyed but dressed. The fire jewel ring on his right hand gleamed in stray sunlight. His sister Kalia walked beside him, her coppery hair held back by a golden clasp. Romber glanced from the sword to the tears brimming in Duncan's eyes.
What's going on here?
Giving Duncan a going-away present. Romber whistled. Pretty fancy for a stable boy.
Perhaps the gift is too much, Duncan said, looking at Duke Leto. He stared at the sword, then glared at Romber.
I'll never work in the stables again, though, Prince Vernius. The next time you see me, I'll be a swordmaster. The sword is yours, Duncan, Leto said in his firmest tone, one he had copied from his father. There will be no further discussion of the matter.
As you wish, my Duke.
Duncan bowed.
I beg to be excused, to prepare for my trip.
The young man strode across the courtyard.
Romber and Kalia sat at the table where their breakfast plates had been set up. Kalia smiled at Leto, but not in her customary warm fashion. For years the pair had been tiptoeing around romantic involvement, with the Duke unwilling to get any closer because of political concerns,
his need to wed the daughter of a powerful great house. His reasons were strictly those his father had drilled into him, a duke's responsibility to the people of Caladan. Only once had Leto and Kalia held hands. He had never even kissed her. Lowering her voice, Kalia said, "Your father's sword, Leto? Was that really necessary? It's so valuable." "But only an object, Kalia. It means more to Duncan than to me. I don't need a sword to retain fond memories of my father." Then Leto noted the blonde stubble on his friend's face, which made Romber look more like a fisherman than a prince. "When was the last time you shaved?" "Vermilion hells. What difference does it make how I look?" He took a drink of cidrit juice, puckered his lips at the tartness. "It's not as if I have anything important to do." Kalia, eating quickly and quietly, studied her brother. She had penetrating green eyes. Her cat-like mouth was turned down in disapproval. As Leto looked across the table at Romber, he noted that his friend's face still retained a childlike roundness, but the brown eyes were no longer bright. Instead, they revealed deep sadness over the loss of his home, the murder of his mother, the disappearance of his father. Now only he and his sister remained of their once great family. "Makes no difference, I suppose," Leto said. "We have no affairs of state to conduct today, no trips to glorious Catane. In fact, you may as well stop bathing altogether." Leto stirred his bowl of pundi rice pudding, then his voice became uncharacteristically sharp. "Nonetheless, you remain a member of my court, and one of my most trusted advisors. By now, I'd hoped you might develop a plan to regain your lost holdings and position." As a constant reminder of the glory days of Ix, when House Vernius had ruled the machine world before the Tleilaxu takeover, Romber still wore the purple and copper helix on the collar of every shirt. Leto noted that the shirt Romber wore was badly wrinkled and needed to be washed. "Leto, if I had any idea what to do, I would jump on the next highliner and try." He looked flustered. "The Tleilaxu have sealed Ix behind impenetrable barricades. Do you want Thufir Hawat to send in more spies? The first three never found their way underground to the cavern city, and the last two vanished without a trace." He tapped his fingers together. "I just have to hope the loyal Ixians are fighting from within and will soon overthrow the invaders. I hope everything will turn out all right." "My friend, the optimist," Leto said. Kalia scowled at her breakfast and finally spoke up. "It's been a dozen years, Romber. How long does it take for everything to magically fix itself?" Uncomfortable, her brother tried to change the subject. "Have you heard that Shaddam's wife just gave birth to their third daughter?" Kalia snorted. "Knowing Shaddam, I'll bet he's none too pleased that it wasn't a male heir." Leto refused to accept such negative thoughts. "He's probably ecstatic, Kalia. Besides, his wife still has many childbearing years left." He turned to Romber. "Which makes me think, old friend, you should take a wife. To keep me clean and make sure I shave? To begin your house again, perhaps. To continue the Vernius bloodline with an heir in exile." Kalia almost said something, seemed to have second thoughts. She finished a melon, nibbled on a piece of toast. Presently she rose and excused herself from the table. During the long silence, tears glistened on the lower lids of the Ixian prince's eyes, then rolled down his cheeks. Embarrassed, he wiped them away.
"Yes. I've been thinking about that myself. How did you know?"
"You've told me so more than once, after we've shared two or three bottles of wine."
"The whole thing is a crazy idea. My house is dead, and Ix is in the hands of fanatics.
So start a new house minor on Caladan, a new family trade. We could look over the list of industries and see what's needed. Kalia has plenty of business sense. I'll provide the resources you need to get established. Romber allowed himself a bittersweet laugh. My fortunes will always remain closely allied with yours, Duke Leto Atreides. No, I'd better remain here to watch your backside, making sure you don't give the whole castle away. Leto nodded without smiling, and they clasped hands in the half-handshake of the Imperium.
Nature commits no errors. Right and wrong are human categories.
Pardo Kynes, Arrakis Lectures. Monotonous days. The three-man Harkonnen patrol cruised over the golden swells of dunes along a 1,000-kilometer flight path. In the unrelenting desert landscape, even a puff of dust caused excitement. The troopers flew their armored ornithopter in a long circle, skirting mountains, then curving south over great pans and flatlands. Glossu Raban, the Baron's nephew and temporary governor of Arrakis, had ordered them to fly regularly, to be seen, to show the squalid settlements that Harkonnens were watching. Always. Keel, the side gunner, considered the assignment a license to hunt any Fremen found wandering near legitimate spice harvesting operations. What made those dirty wanderers think they could trespass on Harkonnen lands without permission from the district office in Carthage? But few Fremen were ever caught abroad in daylight, and the task had grown dull. Garen flew the thopter, rising up and dipping down to catch thermals, as if operating an amusement ride. He maintained a stoic expression, though occasionally a grin stole across his lips as the craft bucked and jostled in rough air. As they completed their fifth day on patrol, he continued to mark discrepancies on topographical maps, muttering in disgust each time he found another mistake. These were the worst charts he had ever used. In the back passenger compartment sat Justin, recently transferred from Geary Prime. Accustomed to industrial facilities, gray skies, and dirty buildings, Justin gazed out over the sandy wastelands, studying hypnotic dune patterns. He spotted the knot of dust off to the south, deep in the open funeral plain.
What's that? Spice harvesting operation?
Not a chance, the side gunner Keel said. Harvesters shoot a plume like a cone into the air, straight and thin.
Too low for a dust devil. Too small.
With a shrug, Garen jerked the thopter controls and soared toward the low, reddish-brown cloud.
Let's take a look.
After so many tedious days, they would have gone out of their way to investigate a large rock sticking out of the sand. When they reached the site, they found no tracks, no machinery, no sign of human presence, and yet acres of desert looked devastated. A mottled rust color stained the sands a darker ochre, as if blood from a wound had dried in the hot sun.
Looks like somebody dropped a bomb here, Keel said. Could be the aftermath of a spice blow, Garen suggested. I'll set down for a closer look.
As the thopter settled on the churned sands, Keel popped open the hatch. The temperature-controlled atmosphere hissed out, replaced by a wave of heat. He coughed dust. Garen leaned over from the cockpit and sniffed hard.
Smell it!
The odor of burned cinnamon struck his nostrils.
Spice blow for sure!
Justin squeezed past Keel and dropped onto the soft ground. Amazed, he bent down, picked up a handful of ochre sand, and touched it to his lips.
Can we scoop up some fresh spice and take it back? Must be worth a fortune.
Keel had been thinking the same thing, but now he turned to the newcomer with scorn.
We don't have the processing equipment. You need to separate it from the sand, and you can't do that with your fingers.
Garen spoke in a quieter but firmer voice.
If you went back to Carthage and tried to sell raw product to a street vendor, you'd be hauled in front of Governor Raban. Or worse yet,
have to explain to Count Fenring how some of the Emperor's spice ended up in a patrolman's pockets. As the troopers tromped out to the ragged pit at the center of the dissipating dust cloud, Jostin glanced around.
Is it safe for us to be here? Don't the big worms go to spice?
Afraid, kid? Keel asked. Let's throw him to a worm if we see one, Garin suggested. It'll give us time to get away. Keel saw movement in the sandy excavation, shapes squirming, buried things that tunneled and burrowed like maggots in rotten meat. Jostin opened his mouth to say something, then clamped it shut again. A whip-like creature emerged from the sand, 2 meters long with fleshy, segmented skin. It was the size of a large snake, its mouth an open circle glittering with needle-sharp teeth that lined its throat.
A sandworm, Jostin said.
Only a runt, Keel scoffed. Newborn, do you think? Garin asked. The worm waved its eyeless head from side to side. Other slithering creatures, a nest of them, squirmed about as if they'd been spawned in the explosion.
Where in the hells did they come from? Keel asked.
Wasn't in my briefing, Garin said.
Can we catch one?
Jostin asked. Keel stopped himself from making a rude rejoinder, realizing that the young recruit did have a good idea.
Come on.
He charged forward into the churned sand. The worm sensed the movement and reared back, uncertain whether to attack or flee. Then it arced like a sea serpent and plunged into the sand, wriggling and burrowing. Jostin sprinted ahead and dove face first to grasp the segmented body 3/4 of the way to its end.
It's so strong!
Following him, the side gunner jumped down and grabbed the thrashing tail. The worm tried to tug away, but Garin reached the front, where he dug into the sand and grabbed behind its head with a stranglehold. All 3 troopers wrestled and pulled. The small worm thrashed like an eel on an electric plate. Other sandworms on the far side of the pit rose like a strange forest of periscopes sprouting from the sea of dunes, round mouths like black O's turned toward the men. For an icy moment, Keel feared they might attack like a swarm of marrow leeches, but the immature worms darted away and disappeared underground. Garin and Keel hauled their captive out of the sand and dragged it toward the ornithopter. As a Harkonnen patrol, they had all the equipment necessary to arrest criminals, including old-fashioned devices for trussing a captive like a herd animal.
Jostin, go get the binding cords in our apprehension kit, the pilot said.
The new recruit came running back with the cords, fashioning a loop which he slipped over the worm's head and cinched tight. Garin released his hold on the rubbery skin and grabbed the rope, tugging while Jostin slipped a 2nd cord lower on the body.
What are we going to do with it?
Jostin asked. Once, early in his assignment on Arrakis, Keel had joined Raban on an abortive worm hunt. They had taken a Fremen guide, well-armed troops, even a planetologist. Using the Fremen guide as bait, they had lured one of the enormous sandworms and killed it with explosives. But before Raban could take his trophy, the beast had dissolved, sloughing into amoeba creatures that fell to the sand, leaving nothing but a cartilaginous skeleton and loose crystal teeth. Raban had been furious. Keel's stomach knotted. The Baron's nephew might consider it an insult that 3 simple patrolmen could capture a worm when he'd been unable to do so himself.
We'd better drown it.
Drown it? Jostin said.
What for? And why would I want to waste my water ration to do that?
Garin stopped as if struck by a thunderbolt.
I've heard the Fremen do it.
If you drown a baby worm, they say it spits out some kind of poison. It's very rare. Keel nodded.
Oh, yeah. The crazy desert people use it in their religious rituals. It sends everybody into frenzied, wild orgies, and a lot of them die. But
We've only got 2 liter jons of water in the compartment, Jostin said, still nervous.
Then we only use one. I know where we can refill it anyway.
The pilot and his side gunner exchanged glances. They had patrolled together long enough that they'd both thought of the same thing. As if understanding its fate, the worm bucked and thrashed even more, but it was already growing weaker.
Once we get the drug, Keel said, let's have some fun.
At night, with the patrol thopter running in stealth mode, they flew over the razor-edged mountains, approaching from behind a ridge and landing on a rough mesa above the squalid village of Bilar Camp. The villagers lived in hollowed-out caves and above-ground structures that extended out to the flats. Windmills generated power. Supply bins glittered with tiny lights that attracted a few moths and the bats that fed on them. Unlike the reclusive Fremen, these villagers were slightly more civilized, but also more downtrodden. Men who worked as desert guides and joined spice harvesting crews. They had forgotten how to survive on their world without becoming parasites upon the planetary governors. On an earlier patrol, Keel and Garen had discovered a camouflaged cistern on the mesa, a treasure trove of water. Keel didn't know where the villagers had gotten so much moisture. Most likely they had committed fraud, inflating their census numbers so that Harkonnen generosity provided more than they deserved. The people of Bilar Camp covered the cistern with rock so that it looked like a natural protrusion, but the villagers placed no guards around their illegal stockpile. For some reason, desert culture forbade thievery even more than murder. They trusted the safety of their possessions from bandits or thieves of the night. Of course, the Harkonnen troopers had no intention of stealing the water. That is, no more than enough for their own needs. Dutifully, Jostin trotted along with their slashing container, which held the thick, noxious substance exuded by the drowned worm after it had stopped thrashing and bucking inside the container. Awed and nervous about what they'd done, they dumped the flaccid carcass near the perimeter of the spice blow and then taken off with the drug. Keel had been concerned that the toxic exhalation from the worm might eat its way through the leader john. Garen operated the Bilar cistern's cleverly concealed spigot and refilled one of their empty containers. No sense in letting all the water go to waste just for a practical joke on the villagers. Next, Keel took the container of worm bile and upended it into the cistern. The villagers would certainly have a surprise next time they all drank from their illegal water hoard.
Serves them right.
Do you know what this drug will do to them? Jostin asked. Garen shook his head.
I've heard plenty of crazy stories.
Maybe we should make the kid try it first, the side gunner said. Jostin backed away, raising his hands. Garen looked at the contaminated cistern again.
I bet they tear off their clothes and dance naked in the streets, squawking like din fowl.
Let's stay here and watch the fun for ourselves, Keel said. Garen frowned.
Do you want to be the one to explain to Raban why we're late returning from patrol?
Let's go, Keel answered quickly. As the worm poison infused the cistern, the Harkonnen troopers hurried back to their ornithopter, reluctantly content to let the villagers discover the prank for themselves. Before us, all methods of learning were tainted by instinct. Before us, instinct-ridden researchers possessed a limited attention span, often no longer than a single lifetime. Projects stretching across 50 or more generations never occurred to them. The concept of total muscle nerve training had not entered their awareness.
We learned how to learn.
Bene Gesserit, Azar Book.
Is this truly a special child?
The Reverend Mother Gaius Helen Mohiam watched the perfectly proportioned girl perform prana bindu muscular nervature exercises on the hardwood floor of the mother school's training module. Recently returned from the abortive banquet on Arrakis, Mohiam tried to look at her student with impartiality, suppressing the truth.
Jessica, my own daughter.
The girl must never know her heritage, must never suspect. Even on the secret Bene Gesserit breeding charts, Mohiam was not identified by her sisterhood adopted name, but by her birth name of Tanidia Neris. 12-year-old Jessica stood poised, arms at her sides, trying to relax herself, trying to arrest the movement of every muscle in her body. Gripping an imaginary blade in her right hand, she stared straight ahead at a chimerical opponent. She summoned untapped depths of inner peace and concentration. But Mohiam's sharp eye noted the barely discernible twitches in Jessica's calf muscles, around her neck, over one eyebrow. This one would need more practice in order to perfect the techniques, but the child had made excellent progress and showed great promise. Jessica was blessed with a supreme patience, an ability to calm herself and listen to what she was told. So focused, this one, so full of potential, as she was bred to be. Jessica fainted to the left, floated, whirled, then stiffened to become a sudden statue again. Her eyes, while looking at Mohiam, did not see her taskmistress and mentor. The stern Reverend Mother entered the training module, stared into the girl's clear green eyes, and saw an emptiness there, like the gaze of a corpse. Jessica was gone, lost among her nerve and muscle fibers. Mohiam dampened a finger and placed it in front of the girl's nose. She felt only the faintest stirring of air. The budding breasts on the slender torso barely moved. Jessica was close to a complete bindu suspension, but not quite. Much hard work remains. In the sisterhood, only total perfection was good enough. As Jessica's instructor, Mohiam would go over the ancient routines again and again, reviewing the steps that must be followed. The Reverend Mother pulled back, studying Jessica, but not rousing her. In the girl's oval face, she tried to identify her own features, or those of the father, Baron Vladimir Harkonnen. The long neck and small nose reflected Mohiam's genetics, but the widow's peak at the hairline, the wide mouth, generous lips, and clear skin derived from the Baron, back when he'd been healthy and attractive. Jessica's widely set green eyes and hair, the color of polished bronze, came from more distant latencies.
If you only knew.
Mohiam recalled what she'd been told of the Bene Gesserit plan. Jessica's own daughter, when grown to womanhood, was destined to give birth to the Kwisatz Haderach, the culmination of millennia of careful breeding. Mohiam looked into the girl's face, searching for any twitch, any hint of grand historical import.
You are not ready to discover this yet.
Jessica began to speak, mouthing word shapes as she recited a mantra as ancient as the Bene Gesserit school itself.
Each attacker is a feather drifting on an infinite path. As the feather approaches, it is diverted and removed. My response is a puff of air that blows the feather away.
Mohiam stepped back as her daughter snapped into a blur of motion, attempting to float through reflex moves. But Jessica still struggled to force her muscles to flow silently and smoothly, when she should have allowed them to do so. The girl's movements were better than before, more focused and precise. Jessica's recent progress had been impressive, as if she'd experienced a mind-clarifying epiphany that lifted her to the next level. However, Mohiam still detected too much youthful energy and unharnessed intensity.
This girl was the product of a vicious rape by Baron Harkonnen after the Sisterhood had blackmailed him into providing them with a daughter. Mohayim had exacted her revenge during the sexual attack, controlling her internal body chemistry in the Bene Gesserit way, inflicting him with a painful, debilitating disease. Such a delightfully slow torture. As his ailment progressed, the Baron had relied on a cane for the past standard year. At the Fenring's banquet, she'd been sorely tempted to tell the gross man what she'd done to him. But if Mohayim had told him, there would have been another act of violence in the dining hall of the residency at Arakeen, far worse than the squabble between the Ikazi and Grumman ambassadors. She might even have found it necessary to kill the Baron with her deadly fighting skills. Jessica herself, despite her limited training, could have dispatched the man, her own father, quickly and easily. Hearing a whir of machinery, Mohayim watched a life-size doll emerge from the floor. The next phase of the routine. In a blur, the girl whirled and decapitated it with a single slashing kick. More finesse. The killing touch must be delicate, precise.
Yes, Reverend Mother.
Still, I am proud of what you have accomplished. Mohayim spoke in an uncharacteristically gentle tone, one that her superiors would not condone had they heard it. Love, in any form, was prohibited. The Sisterhood has great plans for you, Jessica.
Zuta is a word that means many things. Every Bene Tlilox knows it was the name of the first master. But just as that man was more than a mere mortal, so there are depths and complexities in the appellation. Depending upon tone and vocal inflection, Zuta can mean hello or blessings be upon you. Or it can constitute a prayer encompassed in a single word as a devotee prepares to die for the great belief. For such reasons, we have chosen this as our new name for the conquered planet formerly known as Ix. Tliloxu Training Disc. A contingency plan is only as good as the mind that devises it. Deep in the labyrinthine research pavilion, Hidar Phenagetica understood that maxim only too well. One day the Emperor's man would attempt to kill him. Therefore, careful defensive preparations were necessary. "This way, please, Count Fenring," Ajitika said in his most pleasant voice, while thinking, "Unclean Powinda." He glanced peripherally at the man. "I should slay you now." But the master researcher could not accomplish this safely, and might never have the proper opportunity. Even if he did succeed, the Emperor would send in his investigators and even more Sardaukar troops to interfere with the delicate work.
"It is good to hear that you are finally making progress on Project Amal. Elrud the Ninth did commission it over a dozen years ago."
Fenring strolled along a featureless corridor in the underground city. He wore a scarlet imperial jacket and tight-fitting gold trousers. His dark hair was razor-cut, sticking out in patches to emphasize his overlarge head.
"We have been extremely patient."
Ajitika wore a white lab coat with ample pockets. Chemical odors clung to the fabric, his hair, his corpse-like gray skin.
"I warned all of you in the beginning that it could take many years to develop a completed product. A dozen years is a mere eye blink to develop a substance the Imperium has wanted for centuries upon centuries." His nostrils narrowed as he forced a thin smile. "Nevertheless, I am pleased to report that our modified axolotl tanks have now been grown, that preliminary experiments have been conducted and the data analyzed. Based on this,
We have discarded unworkable solutions, thus narrowing down the remaining possibilities.
The Emperor is not interested in narrowed possibilities, Master Researcher, but in results.
Fenring's voice was frozen acid.
Your expenses have been immense, even after we financed your takeover of Ixion facilities.
Our records would stand up to any audit, Count Fenring, Ajitika said. He knew full well that Fenring could never allow a guild banker to look at the expenditures. The Spacing Guild, more than any other entity, must not suspect the aim of this project. All funds have been properly applied. All spice stockpiles are accounted for exactly according to our original agreement.
Your agreement was with Elrood, little man, not with Shaddam, The Emperor can stop your experiments at any moment.
Like Altley Loxu, Ajitika was accustomed to being insulted and provoked by fools. He refused to take offense. An interesting threat, Count Fenring, considering that you personally initiated the contact between my people and Elrood. We have recordings back on the Tliloxu homeworlds.
Fenring bristled and pushed ahead, deeper into the research pavilion. Just by observing you, Master Researcher, I have learned something, he said in an oily voice. You have developed a phobia of being underground, The fear came upon you recently, a sudden onslaught.
Nonsense. Despite his denial, sweat broke out on Ajitika's forehead.
Ah, but I detect something mendacious in your voice and expression. You take medication for the condition, a bottle of pills in the right pocket of your jacket. I see the bulge.
Trying to conceal his rage, Ajitika stammered, I am in perfect health.
I would say that your continued health depends upon how well things are going here. The sooner you complete Project Amal, the sooner you will be able to breathe fresh air again back on beautiful Tliloxu. When was the last time you were there?
A long time ago, Ajitika admitted. You cannot know what it looks like. No Pawint.
He caught himself.
No outsider has ever been permitted beyond the spaceport.
Fenring simply answered with a maddening, too knowing smile. Just show me what you have done here, so that I can report to Shaddam.
At a doorway, Ajitika raised his arm to block Fenring's passage. The Tliloxu closed his eyes and reverently kissed the door. The brief ritual deactivated the deadly security systems, and the door melted into narrow cracks in the wall.
You may enter safely now.
Ajitika stepped aside to let Fenring cross into a white, smooth plaza room where the Master Researcher had set up a number of demonstrations to show the progress of the experiments. In the center of the enormous oval room sat a high-resolution microscope, a metal rack containing laboratory bottles and vials, and a red table holding a dome-shaped object. Ajitika saw intense interest in Fenring's over-large eyes as he approached the demonstration area.
Don't touch anything, please.
Subtle treacheries hung thick in the air, and this Imperial Pawinda would never see or comprehend them until it was too late. Ajitika intended to solve the riddle of the artificial spice, then escape with the sacred axolotl tanks to a safe planet in the farthest reaches of the Imperium. He had made a number of clever arrangements without revealing his identity, using promises and bribes, transferring funds, all without the knowledge of his superiors on the Bene Tliloxu homeworlds. He was alone in this. He had decided that there were heretics among his own people, followers who had adopted their identity as downtrodden scapegoats so well that they had forgotten the heart of the great belief.
He was like a face dancer who had disguised himself so well he had forgotten who he truly was. If Ejidika meekly allowed such people access to his great discovery of Amal, they would surrender the one thing that would gain them the supremacy they deserved. Ejidika planned to continue in his role until he was ready, and then he could take the artificial spice, control it himself, and help his people and their mission, whether they wanted him to or not. Count Fenring murmured as he leaned close to the dome shape on the table.
Most intriguing. Something is inside, I presume.
Something is inside of everything, Ejidika replied. He smiled inwardly as he imagined a glut of artificial spice flowing into the interplanetary marketplace, wreaking economic havoc within Chome and the Lansrod. Like a tiny leak in a dam, a bit of inexpensive melange would ultimately become a raging torrent to turn the Imperium upside down. If played right, Ejidika would be the kingpin of the new economic and political order, not to serve himself, of course, but to serve God. The magic of our God is our salvation. Ejidika smiled at Count Fenring, revealing sharp teeth. Rest assured, Count Fenring, our goals in this matter are mutual. In time, wealthy beyond imagining, Ejidika would develop tests to determine loyalty to his new regime, and he would begin assimilating the Bene Tleilaqs. Though it was too dangerous to bring them into his scheme now, he had several candidates in mind. With proper military support, perhaps even converts among the Sardaukar stationed here, he might even set up headquarters in the lovely capital city of Bandalong. Fenring continued to snoop at the demonstration equipment.
Have you ever heard the saying, trust but verify? It's from Old Terra. You'd be surprised at the little tidbits I pick up. My Bene Gesserit wife collects objects, knick-knacks, and the like. I collect pieces of information.
The Tleilaxu's narrow face twisted into a frown. I see. He needed to finish this annoying inspection as quickly as possible. If you will look over here, please. Ejidika removed an opaque plas vial from the rack and lifted the lid, letting out a strong odor reminiscent of raw ginger, bergamot, and clove. He passed the container to Fenring, who peered at a thick, orangish substance.
Not quite melange, Ejidika said, though chemically it has many spice precursors.
He poured the syrup on a scanning plate, inserted it into the microscope reader, then beckoned Fenring to look through the eyepiece. The Count saw elongated molecules connected to one another like the strands of a cable. An unusual protein chain, the master researcher said. We are close to a breakthrough.
How close?
The Tleilaxu also have sayings, Count Fenring. The closer one gets to a goal, the farther off it appears to be. In matters of scientific research, time has a way of stretching. Only God possesses intimate knowledge of the future. The breakthrough could occur in a matter of days or years.
Double talk, Fenring muttered.
He fell silent when Ejidika pressed a button at the base of the dome. The foggy surface of the plas cleared, revealing sand on the bottom of the container. The Tleilaxu researcher pressed another button, filling the interior with a fine dust. The sand moved, a tiny mound in motion that surfaced like a fish emerging from murky water. A worm shaped the size of a small snake, it was a little over half a meter in length, with tiny crystal teeth.
Sandworm, immature form, Ejidika said. 19 days from Arrakis. We don't expect it to survive much longer.
From the top of the dome, a box dropped to the sand on a hidden suspensor, then opened to reveal more of the glistening orange gelatin.
Amal 1522.16, Ajitika said. One of our many variations. The best we've developed so far. Fenring watched as the mouth of the immature worm quested left and right, revealing glimmering thorns far back in its gullet. The creature slithered toward the orange substance, then stopped in confusion and didn't touch it. Presently it turned and burrowed back into the sand.
"What is the relationship between the sandworms and the spice?" Fenring asked.
"If we knew that, we would have the puzzle solved. If I were to put real spice in that enclosure, the worm would consume it in a primal frenzy. Still, though the worm can identify the difference, at least it did approach the sample. We tempted the beast, but did not satisfy it."
"Nor did your little demonstration satisfy me. I am told that there continues to be an Ixian underground movement causing difficulties. Shaddam is concerned about interference with his most important plan."
"A few rebels, Count Fenring. Inadequately funded, with limited resources. Nothing to worry about." Ajitika rubbed his hands together.
"But they have sabotaged your communication systems and destroyed a number of facilities,
"The death throes of House Vernius, no more. It has been well over a decade, and soon it will die down. They cannot get near this research pavilion."
"Well, your security worries are over, Master Researcher. The Emperor has agreed to dispatch 2 additional legions of Sardaukar as peacekeepers, led by Bashar Kando Garen, one of our best."
A look of alarm and surprise came over the diminutive Tleilaxu. His pinched face reddened. "But that isn't necessary, sir. The half-legion already in place is more than sufficient."
"The Emperor does not agree. These troops will emphasize the importance of your experiments to him. Shaddam will do anything to protect the Amal program, but his patience has run out."
The Count's eyes narrowed.
"You should think of this as good news."
"Why is that? I do not understand."
"Because the Emperor has not yet ordered your execution."
A center for the coordination of rebellion can be mobile. It does not need to be a permanent place where people meet. Kamar Pilru, Ixian ambassador in exile. Treatise on the Downfall of Unjust Governments. The Tleilaxu invaders had instituted a brutal curfew for anyone not assigned to the late work shift. For Keter Pilru, slipping away to attend the hushed rebellion meetings was just another way to thumb his nose at their restrictions. At the freedom fighters' irregular, carefully guarded gatherings, Keter could finally remove his masks and disguises. He became the person he once had been, the person he remained inside. Knowing he'd be killed if caught, the short, dark-haired man approached the meeting place. He clung to oily night shadows between blocky buildings on the cavern floor, making no sound. The Tleilaxu had restored the projected sky on the cavern ceiling, but they had reconfigured the sparkle of stars to show the constellations over their own homeworlds. Here on Ix, even the heavens were wrong. This was not the glorious place it should be, but a hellish prison beneath the surface of the planet. "We will change all that. Someday." During more than a decade of repression, black marketeers and revolutionaries had built their secret network. The scattered resistance groups interacted to exchange supplies, equipment, and information, but each gathering made Keter nervous. If they were caught together, the fledgling rebellion could be snuffed out in a few moments of laser gun fire. When possible, he preferred to work alone, as he had always done.
Trusting no one, he never divulged details of his surreptitious life, not even to other rebels. He'd made private contacts with rare off-worlders at the Port of Entry Canyon. Openings and landing pads in the sheer cliff wall where carefully guarded ships hauled Sleiloxu products to waiting highliners in orbit. The Imperium required vital items of Ixion technology, which were now manufactured under Tleiloxu control. The invaders needed the profits to finance their own work, and they could not risk outside scrutiny. Although they could not seal Ix completely away from the rest of the Imperium, the Tleiloxu used the services of very few outsiders. Sometimes, under the direst of circumstances and at great risk to himself, Kater could bribe one of the transport laborers to skim a shipment or snag a vital component. Other black marketeers had their own contacts, but they refused to share that information with each other. It was safer that way. Now, slipping through the claustrophobic night, he passed an abandoned manufactory, turned onto an even darker street, and picked up his pace. The meeting was about to begin. Perhaps tonight. Though it seemed hopeless, Kater continued to find ways to strike against the Tleiloxu slave masters, and other rebels did the same. Infuriated that they could not capture any saboteurs, the masters made examples out of hapless suboids. After torture and mutilation, the scapegoat would be hurled off the Grand Palais balcony to the distant cavern floor, where great highliners had once been built. Every expression on the victim's face, every dripping wound, was projected on the hollow sky, while recorders transmitted his wails and screams. But the Tleiloxu understood little of the Ixion psyche. Their brutality only caused greater unrest and more incidents of violent rebellion. Over the years, Kater could see the Tleiloxu being worn down, despite efforts to crush the resistance with shape-shifting face dancer infiltrators and surveillance pods. The freedom fighters continued the struggle. Those few rebels with access to uncensored outside news reported on the activities in the Imperium. From them, Kater learned of impassioned speeches before the Landsraad made by his father, the exiled Ixion ambassador. Little more than futile gestures. Earl Dominic Vernius, who'd been overthrown and gone renegade, had vanished completely, and his heir, Prince Romber, lived in exile on Caladan, without a military force and without Landsraad support. The rebels could not count on rescue from the outside. Victory must come from inside. From Ix. He rounded another corner and in a narrow alleyway stepped onto a metal grating. Narrowing his dark eyes, Kater looked from side to side, always expecting someone to spring out of the shadows. His demeanor was furtive and quick, drastically different from the cowed and cooperative routine he followed in public. He gave the password, and the grate lowered, taking him beneath the street. He hurried down a dark corridor. During the day shift, Kater wore a gray work smock. He had learned how to mimic the simple, lackluster suboids over the years. He walked with a stooped gait, eyes dull with disinterest. He had 15 identity cards, and no one bothered to study faces in the shifting masses of laborers. It was easy to become invisible. The rebels had developed their own identity checks. They posted concealed guards outside the abandoned facility under infrared glow globes. Trans eyes and sonic detectors provided a further bubble of protection, none of which would help if the freedom fighters were discovered. On this level, the guards were visible. When Kater mumbled his password response, they waved him inside. Too easily. He had to tolerate these people and their inept security games in order to acquire the equipment he needed, but he didn't have to feel comfortable about it. Kater scanned the meeting site. At least that had been carefully selected.
This closed-down facility had once assembled combat mechs to train fighters against a spectrum of tactics or weapons. But the Tleilaxu overlords had unilaterally determined that such self-aware machines violated the strictures of the Butlerian Jihad. Though all thinking machines had been obliterated 10,000 years before, severe prohibitions were still in effect, and emotions ran high. This place and others like it had been abandoned after the revolt on Ix, production lines left to fall into disrepair. Some equipment had been cannibalized for other uses, the rest turned into scrap. Other pursuits preoccupied the Tleilaxu. Secret work, a vast project staffed only by their own people. No one, not even members of Kater's resistance group, had been able to determine what the overlords had in mind. Inside the echoing facility, flinty-eyed resistance fighters spoke in whispers. There would be no formal agenda, no leader, no speech. Kater smelled their nervous sweat, heard odd inflections in the low voices. No matter how many security precautions they took, how many escape plans they devised, it was still dangerous to have so many gathered in one place. Kater always kept his eyes open, aware of the nearest exit. He had business to conduct. He'd brought a disguised satchel containing the most vital items he had hoarded. He needed to trade with other scavengers to find components for his innovative but problematic transmitter, the Rigaud. The prototype allowed him to communicate through fold space with his twin brother Demur, a guild navigator. But Kater rarely succeeded in establishing contact, either because his twin had mutated so far from human, or because the transmitter itself was falling apart. On a dusty metal table, he brought out weapons components, power sources, communications devices, and scanning equipment. Items that would have led to his immediate execution if any Tleilaxu had stopped to ask his business. But Kater armed himself well, and he had killed the gnomish men before. Kater displayed his wares. He searched the faces of the rebels, the crude disguises and intentional dirt smudges, until he spotted a woman with large eyes, prominent cheekbones, and a narrow chin. Her hair had been raggedly chopped in an effort to destroy any hint of beauty. He knew her as Merala Lakem, though that might not have been her real name. In her face, Kater saw echoes of Kalia Vernius, the pretty daughter of Earl Vernius. He and his twin brother had both fancied Kalia, flirted with her, back when they'd thought nothing would ever change. Now Kalia was exiled on Caladan, and Demur was a guild navigator. The twins' mother, a guild banker, had been killed during the takeover of Ix. And Kater himself lived like a furtive rat, flitting from hideout to hideout. "I found the crystal pack you requested," he said to Miral. She withdrew a wrapped item from a sack at her waist. "I've got the module rods you needed, calibrated precisely. I hope. I had no way of checking." Kater took the packet, feeling no need to inspect the merchandise. "I can do it myself." He handed Miral the crystal pack, but did not ask what she had in mind for it. Everyone present searched for ways to strike against the Tleilaxu. Nothing else mattered. As he exchanged a nervous glance with her, he wondered if she might be thinking the same thing he was, that under different circumstances they might have had a personal relationship. But he couldn't allow her that close to him. Not anyone. It would weaken him and divert his resolve. He had to remain focused, for the sake of the Ixian cause. One of the door guards hissed an alarm, and everyone fell into fearful silence, ducking low. The muted glow globes dimmed. Kater held his breath. A humming sound passed overhead as a surveillance pod cruised above the abandoned buildings, trying to pick up unauthorized vibrations or movements. Shadows smothered the hiding rebels. Kater mentally reviewed the location of every possible escape from this facility, in case he needed to duck out into the blinding darkness. But
but the humming device cruised onward down the length of the city grotto. Shortly afterward, the nervous rebels stood again and began muttering to themselves, wiping sweat off their faces, laughing nervously. Spooked, Kater decided not to remain any longer. He memorized the coordinates for the group's next gathering, packed up his remaining equipment, and looked around, scanning the faces once more, marking them in his mind. If they were caught, he might never see these people again. He nodded a final time at Miral Alekum, then slipped off into the Ixian night, flitting under artificial stars. He had already made up his mind where he would spend the remainder of the sleep shift, and which identity he would choose for the following day.
It is said that the Fremen has no conscience, having lost it in a burning desire for revenge. This is foolish. Only the rawest primitive and the sociopath have no conscience. The Fremen possesses a highly evolved worldview centered on the welfare of his people. His sense
of... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.